Hello everyone, hello. We're gonna get started today. I'm gonna just let the audiobook play. For some of you, this is gonna be a refresher of the book, but I think it's a necessary refresher for a lot of people. Very, very kind of important here to make sure that everyone is on the same page on this topic. Why is it doing this? Okay, well, I'm gonna have to force it. Because it doesn't want to let the first one be the first in queue, so we'll have to, like, play this one at a time. For right now, because it's being a pain in the ass. But yeah, the audiobook is back up. We're gonna listen to it. I'm gonna let people get, like, understanding of this topic because it's important for what we do, and what's going on, and if you don't have an understanding of this, well, welcome it. Yeah, Return of the Book. For those of you wondering, it's this book, this is my copy, which is notated with notes and such, so if you want to follow along and use that, it's very good. I don't feel like reading it myself right now. I'm not doing too hotly. I'm not feeling the greatest, but I still want to stream and present stuff to you, so I think I'm going to just find audiobooks of some of the crucial material and present them to people, especially if they're free copies, like this link. We'll just keep spamming the book and this to people today as they come in, right, so that they can all get started at the start. So without further ado, I'm going to let the audiobook play in the background, and I'm probably not going to talk a whole lot in the background, though I'm working on some things is why, and I'm just not feeling the greatest. So if you have questions, feel free to ask questions. If you have comments, feel free to make comments. We will stop and talk as necessary, right? But I just really want to let y'all start listening to the audiobook.
This is Audible.
Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present The CIA as Organized Crime: How Illegal Operations Corrupt America and the World, by Douglas Valentine. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. Personal violence is for the amateur in dominance. Structural violence is the tool of the professional. The amateur who wants to dominate uses guns. The professional uses social structure. Johann Galtung. Introduction. Chapter 1. How William Colby Gave Me the Keys to the CIA Kingdom. James Tracy. You've been doing historical research for close to 40 years, and I wanted to ask how you orient yourself toward a project, how you know where to look for information that's pertinent to a given story. Valentine. It's complicated, and my experience was different from other writers and researchers I've spoken with about it. From the time I started college back in 1967, I wanted to be a writer. And since then, my philosophy of life has been based on the study of language and literary criticism. I have a very broad approach. I started out studying Greek and Roman literature, reading the Norton anthologies of English and American literature, taking courses in classical myth and the Bible. Very early in my studies, I was introduced to literary criticism, to people like Robert Graves, poet and author of The White Goddess, and Sir James Frazer, who wrote The Golden Bough. Frazer brought a socio-anthropological way of looking at the world of literature. That led me to Carl Jung, Eric Newman, Northrop Frye, and a few other people who approach literature from a variety of different perspectives: psychological, political, anthropological, sociological, historical, philosophical. All those things were of interest to me. When I look at a subject, I look at it comprehensively from all of those different points of view. Literary criticism teaches the power of symbolic transformation, of processing experience into ideas, into meaning. To be a Madison Avenue ad man, one must understand how to use symbols and myths to sell commodities. Ad men use logos and slogans, and so do political propagandists. Left or right, doesn't matter. The left is as adept at branding as the right. To be a speechwriter or public relations consultant, one must, above all, understand the archetypal power of the myth of the hero. That way you can transform, through words, Joe the plumber or even a mass murderer into a national hero. When I decided to research and write about the CIA's Phoenix program, that was how I went at it. I went directly to William Colby, who'd been director of the Central Intelligence Agency. Colby was the person most associated with Phoenix, the controversial CIA assassination program that resulted in the death of tens of thousands of civilians during the Vietnam War. No one had written a book about it, so I wrote Colby a letter and sent him my first book, the Hotel Tacloban. I told him I wanted to write a book that would demystify the Phoenix program, and he was all for that. Colby liked my approach, to look at it from all these different points of view, so he got behind me and started introducing me to a lot of senior CIA people, and that gave me access from the inside. After that, it was pretty easy. I have good interview skills. I was able to persuade a lot of these CIA people to talk about Phoenix. But I also approached it from an organizational point of view, which is absolutely essential when writing about bureaucracies like the CIA or the DEA. You really have to understand them as a bureaucracy, that they...
I want to pause for a second and say something. For those of you who have watched Andor, the system that the ISB has in place, the system that the Empire has in place for planets and the arresting system and the like, that is the galactic version, the galactic scale version of the Phoenix program. That's what it looks like on a galactic scale. And once you realize that, and when you are caught up to date on what the Phoenix program is and what the CIA as organized crime means, then you look at the post-Empire period, the post-first trilogy, not the prequels, but the original four, five, and six. Then you start to realize how the Empire limped on afterwards and the new, the First Order came to be and so on. It really starts to make a lot of sense there. And so that's what I want to pause and give your brain the ability to, like, add as a visual cue to some of this.
Have an historical arc. They begin somewhere. They have a congressional mandate. They have a purpose and organizational and management structures. And in that regard, I really lucked out. One of the first people I interviewed was the CIA officer Nelson Brigham, who actually organized the Phoenix program. Brigham graduated magna cum laude from Yale and was something of an organizational genius. He explained to me how he organized Phoenix. He also explained the different divisions and branches of the CIA so I'd be able to understand it. So I lucked out. Through Colby, I had access to the people in the CIA who created the Phoenix program, and I was able to find out what was on their minds and why they did what they did. That never would have happened if I had gone to the Columbia School of Journalism, or if I'd been involved with journalism for many years. I'd have had a much narrower way of going at the thing. But the CIA officers I spoke with loved the broad view that I was bringing to the subject. They liked me asking them about their philosophy. It enabled me to understand the subject comprehensively. Tracy, there's an associate of William Colby's whom you discuss and write about, also a CIA officer, Evan Parker. You were able to get a great many names from him, and then you ask these people for interviews. The interview subjects, many of whom were CIA personnel, would go back to Colby or Parker and ask if it was okay to speak to you, correct? Valentine. That's right. Once I had Colby's approbation, many CIA officers thought I was in the CIA. No one had heard of me. I wasn't Morley Safer or Seymour Hersh or someone who'd been a celebrity reporter in Vietnam. I was a nobody in the Eduardo Galeano sense of the word. I'd published a book about my father's experiences in World War II, which some of these guys would read. Those who did read The Hotel Tacloban tended to like it, because it was sympathetic to soldiers and showed I understood what it means to be a soldier. Most CIA officers consider themselves to be soldiers. The CIA is set up as a military organization with a chain of command. Somebody tells you what to do, and you salute and do it. Evan Parker had that feeling about me, that I would understand him personally, why he did the things he did, because I'd written this sympathetic book about my father as a soldier, and because Colby sent me to him.
The thing that people didn't recognize is that for those of you who go back and want to read this biography about his father, is that his father's story was about when his father was a POW in a Japanese imperialist prison camp. And his father, a Marine, was planning with other Marines and other imprisoned enlisted men to break out. And there were British officers who had a deal with the Japanese officers who were running the prison camp to rat out people like this who were talking about freedom so that they could maintain certain privileges. And they were ratted out by the British. And the story talks about this and laments the case of these enlisted men. So the CIA men and women think of themselves as soldiers. They're a bunch of LARPing motherfuckers. And then they sit here and they're like, aha, we can use this man to propagate our stuff.
I had an interesting experience with him. He invited me to his house for an interview. And when I arrived, he invited me upstairs to his little den, which was stacked with bookshelves full of Welsh history and poetry books. Parker is a Welsh name. Because of my background in literature, I was able to talk to him about things like the Mabinogion, which is a book about Welsh mythology. I had this broad knowledge that helped me relate to people like him. I put him at ease. Also, for a year before I started interviewing people, I'd read everything I could find about Vietnam and the CIA. I was knowledgeable. Plus, I looked like a good Methodist. I wore a suit and a tie. We spoke for an hour, and Parker got to like me. I hadn't asked him anything about the CIA. We were just getting to know each other. But he had a stack of official-looking documents on his coffee table. He glanced at the documents and politely said he was going down to get us some tea and cookies. It'll take about 15 minutes. I'll be back. He winked and went downstairs. I opened the top folder. It was a roster of everybody in the Phoenix Directorate from when Parker started it in the summer of 1967. I started furiously writing their names and ranks and the position they held in the program. 15 minutes later, as I'm writing the last name, he yells from downstairs, "Doug, the tea is ready. I'm coming up." I closed the file and put my notebook away. He came up with a tray with tea and cookies on it. He winked and sat down, and I started to ask him about Phoenix. We never got to the documents on his desk, but he liked me, and he referred me to people. That's the way it went with most of the CIA people I met. They cooperated because Colby had sent me to them. Like Parker said, Colby was the director, and we still consider him to be the director. If he says you're okay, we believe it. He didn't say, "Now I can waive my secrecy oath," but that's what they did. I talked to members of almost every branch of the CIA, and I approached my interviews organizationally. What kind of a budget did you have? Who was your boss, and how did you report to him? Who worked for you, and what jobs did you give them? I had a big organizational chart in my den, and I'd fill in names and positions. I never asked anyone, "Did you kill anybody? Did you do this kind of illegal thing?" And because I approached it in that benign way, they were confident I was demystifying the program and just sticking to the facts. It had the effect of reverse psychology. They trusted me because I didn't ask them their secrets, so they told me their secrets. They didn't like it in the end, because I exposed all the secrets. I talked to so many people that eventually they all started thinking that I was CIA. Because the CIA compartmentalizes itself, I ended up knowing more about the program than any individual in the CIA. I got a rat-a-tat going and pitted them against each other. They started telling me secrets about their rivals. They all wanted to be the hero in their myth. Tracy, the interviews you conducted and the multitude of conversations you documented were placed alongside actual documentation, which you had to acquire through a considerable amount of research. Valentine, in the interviews, people were giving me original documents to confirm their assertions. Nelson Brigham was the CIA's head of foreign intelligence field operations in Saigon, 1965 to 1967. Brigham managed the liaison officers the CIA placed in the provinces to work with the South Vietnamese Police Special Branch, which is an organization like our FBI. The CIA created and funded the special police and sent them after the Viet Cong's civilian leadership and anyone else trying to undermine the American puppet government. Phoenix is political warfare. He managed the staff that ran all those operations in the provinces. In late 1966, the CIA station chief in Saigon, John Hart, was working on improving operations against the VC's leadership with a CIA officer in Washington, Robert Comer. Comer was Lyndon Johnson's personal aide on pacification in Vietnam, what was called the Other War. Anyway, Hart gave Brigham the task of creating a general staff for pacification, at which point Brigham went to work for Comer. In creating a general staff for pacification, Brigham cobbled together the Phoenix program. And Brigham gave me, over the course of several interviews, copies of all the original documents he wrote for Comer and Hart. These were the enabling documents of the Phoenix program. That happened a lot. I'd ask a guy if he had any documents to back up what he was saying, and if he did, he'd give me copies of what he kept in his library. Everyone thought, because Colby had sent me, that somehow this was all going to be okay. I wasn't going to reveal all this stuff, or that Colby had decided it was okay to reveal all of it. The documents Brigham gave me showed in his own words what he was thinking when he created the Phoenix program. I posted all those documents online at CryptoComb, along with the taped interviews with Brigham, Colby, Parker, and several other CIA and military officers. They are part of the collection titled The CIA Speaks. I put them online, so my critics can't challenge me on the facts, other than by making up things, which they do all the time. I just quoted from these documents and my interviews. So it's accurate reporting. Tracy, there is a Douglas Valentine collection at the National Security Archives at George Washington University. Valentine, yes, the collection contains my interview notes with close to 100 CIA officers and military officers involved in the Phoenix program. People kept referring me to people, and I made some great connections. I met a guy named Tullius Acampora, who recently passed away. He was in his 90s. He'd been an Army counterintelligence officer and worked for General Douglas MacArthur in Shanghai after World War II. When the CIA was formed, Tully, like many Army counterintelligence officers, started working with the counterintelligence staff at the CIA. He was detailed to the CIA. Although he kept his military rank, Tully was a CIA officer for many years. He went to Italy in 1958 and met and worked closely with Bureau of Narcotics agents in Rome. In the 50s and 60s, federal narcotic agents spent half their time doing favors for the CIA, and in exchange, the CIA gave them intelligence on the mobsters they were going after. Tully was sent to Vietnam in 1966 and was involved in one of the anti-infrastructure programs that Phoenix was based upon. Tully's program was called Cong Tac 4, and like Phoenix, it targeted civilians who were functioning as secret agents for the Viet Cong. When the CIA and military created Phoenix, Evan Parker moved into Tully's office. Tully knew the top Vietnamese officials and CIA officers in Vietnam, and he also knew the Italian-Americans who were prominent in the Bureau of Narcotics and later the DEA. Tully and I became personal friends, and he introduced me to senior people from the Bureau of Narcotics and the DEA. The same way I had entree through Colby into the CIA, I had an entree through Tully into federal drug law enforcement at a high level. I met historically important people and got historically important documents, most of it new history. I haven't gotten around to digitizing the tapes of the federal drug law enforcement officers I interviewed, but there are separate collections at the National Security Archive for both my CIA Phoenix program materials and my federal drug law enforcement materials. Tracy, I'm wondering how the former governor of Pennsylvania and Bush administration officer Tom Ridge fits into all this. Was he not involved in Operation Phoenix? Valentine, I'm not sure about Ridge. He was in an infantry unit in Vietnam from late 1969 into 1970. He worked in a team with four Americans and seven Vietnamese soldiers going after insurgents, not North Vietnamese regulars. So he was part of the pacification program. He got a Bronze Star for killing a young man carrying a sack of potatoes. He may have been a sniper, and he may have been involved in one of the programs Phoenix coordinated, but it doesn't seem like he was a Phoenix advisor. Rich had been a governor and had executive management experience when he was appointed to run the Office of Homeland Security and later the Department of Homeland Security, DHS. He was a political cadre who could be trusted to implement Republican Party policy. At the same time, the Department of Homeland Security was based on the Phoenix Program model Nelson Brigham developed in Vietnam. Ridge may have had some related pacification experience, which is what Homeland Security is, but he certainly understood how to manage organizations. The key word is coordination. When the National Security Establishment wanted to centralize the war on terror here in the United States through the DHS, they copied how Phoenix had coordinated multiple agencies in order to streamline and bureaucratize the war against the Viet Cong infrastructure, VCI. Phoenix proved an incredibly successful model for pacification in South Vietnam. It was the silver lining in the Vietnam War. Politically, the war was a disaster, but bureaucratically, the Phoenix program succeeded. It became the model for CIA operations in Central America, the Salvador option. The Phoenix program established intelligence operations and coordinating centers in the provinces and districts, PIOCCs and DIOCCs, of South Vietnam. Similarly, the Department of Homeland Security has created fusion centers in every state and major city across the country. The fusion centers coordinate all the agencies in an area exactly like IOCCs did in Vietnam. Systematized and computerized, they coordinate contributing intelligence analysts and operating units. It's the same highly bureaucratized system for dispensing with anything and anyone who can't be assimilated. Tracy, that's an ominous set of observations for someone who has studied the Phoenix program in such great depth. You're saying the Phoenix template is something that has been grafted onto the American homeland. Valentine, absolutely. And I'm not the only one that talks about it. David Kilcullen was a counterinsurgency advisor to the Bush and Obama administrations, and in 2004, he called for a global Phoenix operation. Tom Hayden described Kilcullen as the chief advisor on counterinsurgency operations to General David Petraeus in planning the 2007 U.S. troop surge in Iraq. He also served as chief strategist in the State Department's counterterrorism office in 2005 and 2006, and has been employed in Iraq, Pakistan, Afghanistan, the Horn of Africa, and Southeast Asia. In the section titled A Global Phoenix Program in his 2004 article, Kilcullen describes the Vietnam Phoenix Program as unfairly maligned and highly effective. Dismissing CIA sponsorship and torture allegations as popular mythology, Kilcullen calls Phoenix a misunderstood civilian aid and development program that was supported by pacification operations to disrupt the Viet Cong, whose infrastructure ruled vast swaths of rural South Vietnam. A global Phoenix program, he wrote, would provide a starting point for dismantling the worldwide jihadist infrastructure today. Tracy, how did Kilcullen want to see a Phoenix program imposed upon the world? Valentine, if he understood it correctly, he'd know that the strength of the Phoenix program was in the IOCC centers, which allowed for political control. Through a network of Phoenix centers, management is able to control targeting and messaging. I imagine Kilcullen wanted such highly bureaucratized centers set up in or near nations in which the CIA and military are hunting terrorists. Such centers would allow the White House to direct the CIA to direct the military to target the right terrorists. Leave ours alone. Seymour Hersh is always looked to for insight into the CIA. In December 2003, he wrote an article in The New Yorker in which he said the special operations people in the military were going to use Phoenix as a model in Iraq. True to his high-toned style, Hersh focused on the sensational death squad aspect of Phoenix, not the revealing organizational aspect. He keeps the focus narrow. Phoenix is greater than the sum of its parts because it has symbolic meaning. But its lurid aspects, like the death squads Hersh emphasizes, grab everyone's attention. In Iraq, the CIA handed out decks of playing cards featuring pictures of high-value Sunni officials in the Saddam Hussein government. That Psy War gimmick and jargon was right out of the Phoenix program. The purpose of the Phoenix program was to neutralize the civilian members of the underground revolutionary government in South Vietnam. Neutralize was a broad term that included a number of measures. The first step was to identify a suspected subversive. After that, Nelson Brigham, the CIA officer who created Phoenix in 1967, explained the process to me as follows. My motto was to recruit them. If you can't recruit them, defect them. That's Chu Hoi. If you can't defect them, capture them. If you can't capture them, kill them. That was my attitude toward high-level VCI. VCI was the acronym for Viet Cong Infrastructure, the name the CIA gave to the members of the Revolutionaries' underground government and guerrilla support system. As part of its congressional mandate, the CIA has the job of counter-subversion outside the United States. Thus, when the U.S. is waging a counterinsurgency in a nation like Iraq or Afghanistan, the CIA pursues a political order of battle, while the U.S. armed forces pursue a military order of battle. In practice, however, counter-subversion during a counterinsurgency is a paramilitary police function. Thus, in South Vietnam, the U.S. military supported the CIA's Phoenix program with troops and equipment. In 1969, the CIA ostensibly turned the Phoenix program over to the U.S. military, at which point soldiers first began to pursue a political order of battle and conduct systematic counter-subversive operations against foreign civilians. The creation of Phoenix was a watershed. Prior to it, military people were only allowed to target civilians if they were secret agents or guerrillas attacking military bases or personnel. But in its fanatical pursuit of victory in Vietnam, the military deliberately blurred the lines between subversives and innocent civilians, and killed anyone who got in the way, including children, like it did at My Lai and 1,000 other places. Following its ignoble defeat in Vietnam, America was driven by a reactionary impulse to reassert its global dominance. The justifications used to rationalize Phoenix were institutionalized as policy, as became evident after 9/11 and the initiation of the War on Terror. Since then, the CIA and U.S. military have been conducting joint Phoenix-style operations worldwide without any compunctions, most prominently in Afghanistan and Iraq. Also evolving was the relationship between the CIA, the military, and the media. In Vietnam, there was more press freedom, and the carnage was filmed and shown on TV every night. But the CIA and military felt those images turned the public against the war. So by the time America invaded Iraq in 2003, reporters were embedded in military units. The media became a PR unit of the military and the CIA, with the Orwellian result that the public did not see images of the mangled bodies. The public was denied access to the truth of what its government was actually doing, and when Chelsea Manning leaked the collateral murder video to WikiLeaks, she was summarily tried and imprisoned. When I was doing my interviews for the Phoenix program, certain CIA people would tell me how a particular correspondent from CBS or the New York Times would come into their offices and ask about the programs they managed. The CIA officers would talk openly about their operations, but the Vietnam-era correspondents wouldn't publish the details because their editors had a gentleman's agreement with the CIA not to reveal the secrets. They could know the secrets, and as long as they didn't reveal them, they could continue to have access. While I was researching Phoenix, I went to people like Seymour Hersh and Gloria Emerson, but they wouldn't talk to me. I had a harder time getting reporters to talk to me than I did CIA people, because as soon as they expressed any knowledge about Phoenix, the follow-up question was, why weren't you writing about it? Then they'd have to reveal this gentleman's agreement with the CIA. The Old Boy Network existed in Vietnam, but it's gotten a lot worse. It's impossible now for anyone to interview mid-level CIA people on the record and reveal the facts. Since Iran-Contra, the bureaucracies have instituted incredible obstacles that make it impossible for people to see what's going on inside their private club. The public is totally reliant now on whistleblowers like Chelsea Manning and Edward Snowden, who are then vilified, imprisoned, and or chased into exile. Tracy, We see what, for example, happened to Gary Webb in the mid-1990s.
Hey, Drezzy, we're just listening to the CIA as Organized Crime audiobook right now while I do some work, because I'm just kind of, like, hurting a little bit and trying to get some stuff related to the farm project going. Hope you're doing well as well. Hope everyone who is here is enjoying themselves. I know it's probably a little boring for some of you who are expecting something more, but this book is really important for actually understanding what's going on today around you, because, like, if you're wondering why there are more fascists on the street, if you're wondering why some of this stuff is going on, well, this book is gonna really make you go, holy shit.
He had some people who had divulged significant information to him, and yet the CIA denied it, and that more or less cost him his career. He had no one. No colleagues of his who actually went to bat for him to any significant degree to keep him in the industry, because what he was doing is what investigative journalists and historians such as you should be doing. Valentine. Yes. Gary Webb was an investigative journalist whose Dark Alliance series in 1996 exposed the link between the CIA's Contras in Central America and a crack cocaine dealer in Los Angeles. The story rattled the CIA. Members of the black community were up in arms. Then the CIA's old boy network sprang into action, and Webb was nitpicked to death by fellow journalists for minor inaccuracies in his work. But his real sin was revealing the CIA's criminal involvement in systematic racial oppression through the war on drugs. Webb committed suicide in 2004. But he wasn't the first American citizen to be attacked for telling the truth about the CIA's central role in drug trafficking. In his 1972 book, The Politics in Heroin in Southeast Asia, Al McCoy detailed much of the CIA's drug network in Vietnam and the Golden Triangle region of Laos, Burma, and Thailand. When the CIA found out what McCoy was doing, one of its most senior executives, Cord Meyer, tried to get McCoy's publisher to suppress the book. When that didn't work, the CIA tapped McCoy's phone, and the IRS audited his income tax. Behind the scenes, the CIA forced McCoy's sources to recant. The famous Church Committee, which exposed a lot of the CIA's secrets, investigated McCoy's allegations and found the CIA innocent of any involvement in drug trafficking. McCoy moved to Australia and didn't return to America for 11 years. The CIA's control of international drug trafficking is America's darkest secret. And after the Webb scandal, the Old Boy Network imposed even more restrictions on the media. The pressures the CIA imposes on the media amount to political warfare directed against the American public. It's no different than how the CIA mounts counter-subversion operations overseas. Nowadays, the only way you can discern what's going on is by studying and understanding the historical arc of these bureaucracies. Where did the CIA come from? Where is it going? If you look at it historically, you can see beyond the spin and it becomes demystified. And that is not a happy story. As power gets more concentrated in the security services, the media is no longer simply compliant. It's functioning as their public relations arm. It simply ignores anything that contradicts the official line. Tracy, there is almost a complete blackout of Jade Helm in the mainstream media. It is only getting coverage and discussion and analysis in the alternative media. Valentine. Yes, Jade Helm was a military training exercise in Texas, Arizona, Florida, Louisiana, Mississippi, New Mexico, and Utah. Military and local officials set up Phoenix-style coordination centers as a way of giving special operations and civil affairs personnel experience working with paramilitarized police forces in what was called a realistic war experience in domestic counterinsurgency operations. The media blackout was an essential part of the plan. The censorship was symbolic of how, as a function of the concentration of capital, the communications/media industry has been centralized and is now part of the political warfare apparatus. The media industry has been reduced to a few huge corporations that control most of the outlets. Control of information has become the key to the oligarchy's success. Very few independent news organizations are able to compete with the giants or get information out across the country, so people really have to search for facts on the internet. Tracy, even some of the alternative progressive left media that were good 20 or so years ago are increasingly dependent upon foundation money that comes with strings attached, and they're not as inclined to push the envelope as I think they once were. Valentine, sure. As a person who is interested in how the CIA uses language and mythology to control political and social movements, I see this development as ominous. People like Glenn Greenwald, who take money from billionaires, insist it has no editorial influence on them. But media people who are taking money from billionaires and CIA-connected foundations must realize that their sugar daddies can sink their operations in a moment because of something they write, and that knowledge surely impacts what they are willing to do and say. Taking money from a billionaire also has tremendous symbolic meaning. It means the person taking the money approves of one person having $8 billion when 3 billion people barely survive. Through their example, celebrity media figures like Greenwald are telling their followers that they support the exploitation and imperialism their benefactors engage in. As all advertising people know, symbolic messages don't have to be articulated. They're understood subliminally. Greenwald's followers like it that way. It means they don't have to consciously confront their tacit support for an unjust system. That self-censorship allows celebrity journalists like Greenwald and his sidekick, Jeremy Scahill, to promote themselves as heroic adversaries of the system. And they'll continue to get away with the double game until their followers start challenging their own basic assumptions. The system will never change until people climb out of their comfortable darkness and start rejecting the system's inequalities instead of just feeding off of them. Tracy, you mentioned Greenwald. There are other prominent figures on the left who fashion themselves as freedom fighters in the informational sphere, where that's arguably not the case. This is something that I think goes back over 40 years to Daniel Ellsberg. The most important case in the freedom of the press in the 20th century, if not the country's history, was the Pentagon Papers, and yet Ellsberg himself was a member of the CIA. Valentine. Well, Greenwald and Ellsberg certainly aren't left, and Ellsberg was not a fully integrated, backstopped employee of the CIA. But for a period of time in 1965 and 1966, he did work for the CIA's station chief in Saigon, John Hart, whom I mentioned earlier as having initiated the Phoenix program, gathering intelligence on what prominent South Vietnamese politicians and officials were thinking. I was told that Ellsberg could recall conversations verbatim, and that he was introduced to these important political people at social events, and then reported to Hart about their thoughts. He was also working at a high level in the pacification programs upon which Phoenix was based. Ellsberg worked with CIA officers Edward Lansdale and Lucien Conin, and U.S. Information Service officer Frank Scotton, about whom more remains to be said. The problem is that Ellsberg presented himself in his autobiography as having been working with the State Department. That was his cover. And in the movie about him, he's pictured in an army uniform on patrol. He misrepresented himself. He wasn't honest. All of his work with the CIA is absent. Why? It goes back to the fact that Ellsberg was a full-fledged hawk who turned against the Vietnam War. But after he leaked the Pentagon Papers, the left adopted him as a symbol of someone who saw the light. The left takes credit for ending the war, and Ellsberg is a central character in its narrative. So the anti-war movement in particular, and the left, whatever that is, in general, goes along with the cover story. But people can't understand the significance of the Pentagon Papers or the true nature of the Vietnam War without understanding Ellsberg's work for the CIA. His worldview was defined by his intimate relationships with his mentor, Ed Lansdale, and the other political warfare people he worked with in Vietnam, especially Frank Scotton. Ellsberg, Scotton, and a handful of other experts prepared America's organizational blueprint for pacifying South Vietnam's civilian population in the seminal Roles and Missions Report in August 1966. That study sets the stage for the Phoenix program. All this loops back to the issue of access. I didn't know who Scotton was until Colby referred me to him in 1986. Like the other people Colby referred me to, Scotton thought I was CIA approved. He tried to impress me, and when I interviewed him at his home in McLean, Virginia, he said, "We," which could only have meant him and Colby, had instructed Ellsberg to release the Pentagon Papers. Scotton has since written an autobiography in which he denies having told Ellsberg to do it. He now says Ellsberg merely showed him the Pentagon Paper documents in 1970. All this also loops back to CIA drug trafficking. A moment ago, I mentioned that Al McCoy's sources had recanted. Chief among McCoy's sources who recanted was Dan Ellsberg's former comrade, Lou Conine. When McCoy spoke to him in the summer of 1971, Conine confessed to having arranged a truce between the CIA and Corsican drug traffickers in 1965 at the same time he was working with Ellsberg. The summer of 1971 was a busy time as well. Colby was due to testify to Congress about the Phoenix program in July, but a larger event grabbed the headlines. On June 13, 1971, the New York Times began printing lengthy excerpts from the Pentagon Papers, that painstakingly edited stack of documents that, even by name, deflected attention away from the CIA. Consequently, little public attention was paid when, on July 15, 1971, the Times reported, "Previously classified information read into the record of a House Government Operations Subcommittee today disclosed that 26,843 non-military Viet Cong insurgents and sympathizers were neutralized in 14 months through Operation Phoenix." All these threads weave together to create the myths Americans believe about the CIA, and Ellsberg's cover story is part of the fictionalized tale. Tracy, the reluctance of certain editors to publish what you've researched and revealed about Ellsberg, do you think in part that has to do with just a wish to sustain the legend of Ellsberg, the symbol of what he's become? Valentine, sure. They're part of the same network of management-level media people the CIA influences. What CIA officer Cord Meyer dubbed the compatible left. Let me tell you about my experience with the compatible left. William Morrow and Company published the Phoenix program in 1990, but before it hit the bookstands, the New York Times gave it a terrible review. After that, the media wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. As far as the left was concerned, the book presented new material they couldn't digest. I guess it threatened their proprietary claim on Vietnam War history. The militant right was never going to acknowledge it anyway, but the left's leadership is part of the CIA's old boy network. And like all American intellectuals, they look to the Times for direction and validation. So the word went out to ignore the book, not just because it revealed CIA secrets, but because it identified the media, and the Times in particular, as the reason why the public can't see the CIA clearly for what it is, a criminal conspiracy on behalf of wealthy capitalists. I had also noted that the release of the Pentagon Papers distracted attention from congressional hearings into Phoenix. In subsequent books, I added that it distracted attention from reports on CIA drug trafficking as well. In any event, all my access to the CIA was meaningless. The CIA, through its friends in the media, was able to neutralize me. Only a handful of people recognized the book's historical value, people like Al McCoy, who called the book the definitive account in a blurb for the iUniverse edition. But my supporters all had the same response. I'd crossed the line and would never get another book published in the United States. So I learned the hard way that the CIA has a strategic intelligence network of management-level people in the information industry who know, through instruments like the Times Book Review section, what books and authors to marginalize. Peter Dale Scott had also been marginalized as a result of his 1972 book, The War Conspiracy, and his 1993 book, Deep Politics and the Death of JFK. Peter supported me. And a few years after the Phoenix book was published, I mentioned to him that I was writing an article based on my interviews with Scotton and Conneen about Ellsberg's deep political association with the CIA. Peter is Ellsberg's friend, and even though the article had the potential to embarrass Ellsberg, he arranged for me to interview him. Peter gave me Ellsberg's number, and I called at a prearranged time. And the first thing Ellsberg said to me was, "You can't possibly understand me because you're not a celebrity." If you want to understand the critical role celebrities play in determining what society accepts as real and valuable, read Guy Debord's books, The Society of the Spectacle and its sequel, Comments. Debord explains the symbolic role celebrities play, at times inadvertently, in maintaining the illusions we confuse with reality. Debord cites the German philosopher Ludwig Feuerbach, who famously said, "But certainly for the present age, which prefers the sign to the thing signified, the copy to the original, representation to reality, the appearance to the essence, illusion only is sacred, truth profane. Nay, sacredness is held to be enhanced in proportion as truth decreases and illusion increases, so that the highest degree of illusion comes to be the highest degree of sacredness." When Ellsberg told me he was a celebrity, he was saying that he underwent a symbolic transformation the moment he leaked the Pentagon Papers and landed in a social realm that alienated him from non-celebrities like me. He became an icon. And nobody on the left is about to say, "Oh my God, Valentine had this revelation about Ellsberg. Let's rethink everything we believe is true." Like its doppelgangers on the right, the management class on the left is invested in celebrity heroes who represent their business interests. They focus on the symbol and ignore any contradictory but essential facts. The way Greenwald and Scahill ignore Pierre Omidyar's funding of the Center for the United Action in Kiev, which was a Phoenix-style coordination center for covert political action. If the owners of a symbol are forced to talk about an embarrassing fact that undermines their business interests, they interpret the fact narrowly. This is one of the methodologies the political parties and their compatible media outlets employ. They summarize and misrepresent a problematic subject in 9 seconds and then repeat the summary over and over again. They don't take the approach of a literary critic. They don't look honestly at what the government's carefully chosen words mean. They don't look for what's not said. In fact, they play the same game. Their methods are identical. I experienced the same thing when I wrote my article about Ellsberg. No one on the American left would publish it. Eventually, Robin Ramsey published it in Lobster magazine in Great Britain. The article was called "The Clash of the Icons" and demonstrated that Ellsberg and Al McCoy held contradictory positions about the CIA's relationship with drug traffickers in Vietnam. McCoy accused CIA officers Ed Lansdale and Lou Conneen of collaborating with Corsican drug smugglers in 1965. At the same time, Ellsberg was working closely with them. But when I interviewed him, Ellsberg insisted that these CIA officers were not involved in the drug traffic, despite overwhelming evidence to the contrary. Several years later, Alex Cockburn and Jeff St. Clair published my Ellsberg article in Counterpunch. They were having fun ridiculing wacky left assumptions and sacred cows, like Israel. They loved my Phoenix Program book and my article on Ellsberg, which they renamed "Will the Real Daniel Ellsberg Please Stand Up?" They featured it in Counterpunch, and of course everyone on the left ignored it. Maintaining Ellsberg's image is mostly a business decision, because Ellsberg is what the mafia calls a moneymaker. If one of these compatible left media outlets has Ellsberg talk at a peace conference it's sponsoring, 100 fans will pay cash to see him. The compatible left is a business venture that's dependent on the capitalist society within which it operates. At the same time, Ellsberg is a symbol of the illusion that change is possible within the system. He calls for reform, yes, and like the compatible left, he backs many important progressive programs. But more importantly, by covering up his own CIA connections, he's reassuring the bourgeoisie that subscribes to these media outlets that everything they assume about their leaders is right, And that's how symbolic heroes mislead the way. This is Ellsberg's symbolic function. As a certified hero who has achieved celebrity status, he proves the system works. He leaked the Pentagon Papers and stopped the war. And he suffered for it. President Nixon wanted to put him on trial for treason. Nixon's staff pulled all sorts of dirty tricks to intimidate and discredit him, but he soldiered on. That's the myth of the hero. But there are no heroes, and the system doesn't work for everyone, like it rewards Amy Goodman at Democracy Now, or like it rewards Greenwald and Scahill. If Ellsberg were to reveal the CIA's secrets, he would no longer have the same reassuring effect on the liberal bourgeoisie. So his sponsors never mentioned that he had an affair with the mistress of a Corsican drug smuggler in Saigon. That's not in the book or the movie. He denies his CIA buddies were involved in the drug trade, even though they were. He won't talk about the CIA war crimes he witnessed or the contradictions of capitalism. Like Seymour Hersh and other liberal media icons, he avoids naming CIA officers or detailing the CIA's class functions. He's an ex.
You'll notice this about Hersh's recent stuff about the Nord leak. Hersh didn't name any specific units, specific branches. He didn't name any specific methods that were used. He just said that it was NATO, that it was the CIA. The limited hangout doing its job. So, like, telling everyone what everyone already knew, but giving us no way to actually go about stopping this from happening again and again and again.
Expert who tells the bourgeoisie it's all under control. He serves this symbolic function, and he's been doing it for 40 years. And if, like me, you violate his sanctity by revealing the truth, you'll never get published by the compatible left. You lose access. Tracy, a recent incarnation of Daniel Ellsberg might be Jeremy Scahill. You mentioned Democracy Now! A moment ago. He was a correspondent for them in the early 2000s, when the Iraq War was ramping up along with the War on Terror. Valentine, Ellsberg was never a reporter or a media mogul like Scahill, but they are both celebrities. Ellsberg with the older generation, Scahill with naive millennials. They are also similar in that Scahill made a grandiose documentary film about himself in which he characterized himself as a hero. He barely mentioned the CIA in the film, and his publication, The Intercept, avoids any analysis of the CIA as an instrument of capitalism and imperialism. Scahill and Greenwald have the same pacifying effect on the liberal bourgeoisie as Ellsberg. They rile them up a bit with recycled exposés, but symbolically, they're part of the system. They style themselves as alternative, but they're not about to engage in self-criticism or risk revealing the critical evidence that would indict individual CIA officers. It's a catch-22. Until the media stops covering for the CIA, people will never understand how illegal covert operations systematically distort our basic assumptions about everything. Meanwhile, these media celebrities perpetuate all the myths upon which the class system is based. Greenwald and Scahill are too busy grabbing for the candy and portraying themselves as heroes and winners who made it big. Tracy, the war on drugs, as you chronicle in your books, fundamentally changes in the late 1960s and early 1970s. Can you provide us an overview of the CIA's increased involvement up to the present? Valentine, the Bureau of Narcotics was removed from Treasury and recreated as the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs in the Justice Department in 1968 because it had gathered indisputable evidence that the CIA was running the Golden Triangle narcotics business. The heroin being sold to American soldiers in Vietnam was coming from the CIA's clients in Laos. Al McCoy wrote about this back in 1972. The CIA was protecting the major opium producers in the Golden Triangle, just like they've been protecting the major drug dealers in Afghanistan for the last 15 years. They were funneling heroin and opium to their warlords in South Vietnam as a payoff for advancing the U.S. policies that were detrimental to their own country. The CIA bought their services by allowing them to deal narcotics and a lot of the dope made its way back to the homeland through enterprising soldiers and various criminal organizations. It was a criminal conspiracy of the highest order. The National Security Establishment realized the conspiracy was on the verge of being exposed in 1968, so it pulled various executive management, enforcement, and intelligence functions out of the BNDD and gave them to the CIA so the CIA could protect its drug smuggling assets around the world. At that point, federal drug law enforcement became an adjunct of national security. Tracy, so this firewall that theoretically exists between the CIA operations abroad and in the United States has been bypassed in the war on drugs. Valentine, yes. And by studying the relationship between the CIA and federal drug law enforcement, you can see why I refer to the CIA as the organized crime branch of the U.S. government. Nowhere is that more evident than in how it controls international drug networks. If you're a general in Bolivia and you're assassinating leftists, the CIA will allow you to deal drugs. If you're Manuel Noriega and you're providing intelligence on revolutionaries in Central America, you're allowed to deal drugs. If you're a South Vietnamese general or an Afghan warlord, you're allowed to deal drugs because you're furthering the national security interests of the United States.
And not just the national security interests, but the farm interests of these country of this Western Empire too. So agribusiness is being promoted. The big drug industry are being promoted, right? And this is where a lot of individual opinions on this topic diverge into places they don't need to go, because all of this is just about ensuring profit margins for these already massive industries that have existed for several hundred years now. And have wanted to stay at the top since they got to the top.
States, which means it's corporate as well as political and social interests. In order for this to happen, two things are important. The CIA has to control certain branches of the DEA, and it has to control the media. And it has systematized its control over these institutions. Chapter 2.
All right, we're going to take a small pause here. I'm going to do an ad break, and I'm going to get up and stretch a little bit. Everybody else should, too. You know, we've been at this for almost an hour with this chapter. Everybody just take some time, take a break, take care of yourself. I do apologize that I have to run the ads, but this is my only stream of income, and it's the only way Faye and I are able to, like, try and maintain ourselves. So I'm just trying to make the most out of it. For those of you who don't use an ad blocker, I appreciate you. If you do use an ad blocker, good shit. Don't need to watch the ads. I approve of ad blockers and piracy. You know, I'm a big pirate fan. So I gotta do what I gotta do. You gotta do what you gotta do. We're all in this together sort of thing. If you would like to support me more directly, my links are here. Cash App, PayPal, Patreon. Bunch of different ways that you can support Faye and I if you would like to support us and keep doing this content and stuff. I'm working on stuff for the farm project in the background here while we work on this. I'm trying to get the starter kit documentation set up. Basically, and Pasta will tell you this too, a lot of what we have to do now is paperwork stuff for other people, unless you're really gung-ho about the farming and you want to get in on the ground floor, ground zero stuff, and like be like an actual farmer kind of thing. But many people are more interested in this in a different aspect, so we're trying to get that angle set up for more people. But yeah, it's going to be good. It's going to be great. So I will be back un momento, and then we'll have this keep going. For now, though, let me turn on some music, and yeah, quick break. Okay. Hello. I'm back. Let us begin. I hope everyone enjoyed the break. We have chapter 2. The audiobook is a very good book. It's very helpful. If you have questions, please feel free to ask. I'm just working over here in the background on the farm project paperwork that needs to get done. Things like, say, how much the starter kit costs, what goes in the starter kit, how to set up the starter kit, first steps, things like that. All the goody-goody gumdrop stuff. Because, like, we need to have the multiple things. Okay? So we need... Excuse me. Excuse me. So we need like a document form because not everyone wants a video form. But document form doesn't work for everyone. So video form works. But not everyone wants the video form. Some people would like a document form and a picture form. So we have to have the various formats so that everyone's method of learning and understanding is there and available to them. And yeah, again, for all of y'all coming in, here's the link to the movie, the playlist, the first, the audiobook part one. It's intro chapter one and part of chapter two in this one, and then the next one will be chapter two and more. And so we're just gonna keep listening.
One thing leads to another. My rare access in investigating the war on drugs. Ryan Dawson, let's discuss the relationship between crime and law enforcement. You talked about this in an article about an experience you had growing up in New York. Let's start off with what you learned in your young adulthood, and do tell about the relationship between crime and law enforcement, if there can even be a line. Valentine, what I learned is that there isn't a line. The story I'm going to tell about my experience is allegorical. It's a microcosm of the way the world works, how propaganda and Madison Avenue advertising convince people that there are forces of good fighting forces of evil. But if people saw through the propaganda, they'd have different attitudes, and our country would be structured differently. But the lawmaking branch of our government is in the hands of professional criminals. Everything they do is in the service of crime, of holding down or stealing from the poor, and protecting or giving to the rich. I came to realize all this as a young person, thanks to my father. The lesson my father taught me occurred in 1968, just 23 years after World War II. It's almost 50 years since then, so the experience I had was contextually closer to the good war than the bad Vietnam War. Adult men in 1968 viewed America as having saved the world for democracy. It was easier to be rebellious back then, when millions of middle-class white males had to re-educate themselves and support one another in order to avoid being killed for Dow Chemical and Dow Jones in Vietnam. My father worked in the post office in the village where he'd lived as a child. He worked the graveyard shift, and I worked for a tree company in town. I was home from college for the summer, and I worked for the Cogshaw Tree Company, climbing trees. My father and I didn't get along, but I ate breakfast in the same diner where my father had a cup of coffee after getting off the graveyard shift. These were the days of the generation gap. He sat on one side of the diner by the kitchen door, with the cops and the older blue-collar workers. They'd talk about how much they hated Muhammad Ali, who had refused to go to Vietnam, and Joe Willie Namath. My friends and I had long hair and resisted the war. We were smoking dope and taking acid, and our girlfriends were young and pretty and sexually liberated, thanks to the pill, so they hated us too. One day my father and I met at the cash register. He was waiting for me when I got outside. "I want you to meet me tomorrow at the bank," he said. "There's something I want to show you. Come about an hour early." We didn't get along, but he was my father, so I did what he said. The bank was at the other end of Wheeler Avenue, but not far from the diner. My great-uncle Tom Colligan worked there as a security guard. Tom had been a cop in town for many years. My father's father had been a cop in town, too, during Prohibition. Anyway, we met at the bank the next morning and walked down Wheeler Avenue toward the diner. The sun was just coming up and nobody was on the street. We got to the corner store at the end of Wheeler Avenue and turned right up Manville Road. The diner was a few steps up the street, and I could see the bread delivery truck parked in front of it. Another car was parked beside it. I knew who the car belonged to. My father walked into the street with me following behind. He stood behind the delivery truck, flung the back doors open, and said to me, "Take a good look. This is the true relationship between crime and law enforcement." Inside was the bakery truck driver, the mafia representative who picked up the money and slips from the local bookie. The bookie worked at the diner and was sitting beside the bread truck driver. In the back of the truck were three village cops. I'd known them all my life. I went to school with their kids. I knew their names. They'd been caught red-handed and their mouths were hanging open. When they started muttering curses, my father abruptly closed the doors. He walked away and went about his business. Me too. The next day, I was back in the diner, and nobody said a word. It was like I'd been initiated into a secret society. Most of the people in town had no idea this was going on. They thought the cops give you a speeding ticket. They don't see the cops associating with professional criminals and making money in the process. They believe that when a guy puts on a uniform, a guy who was a bully in school and didn't develop the skills to be a plumber or go to college, he becomes virtuous. But the guys who go into law enforcement relate more to the crooks they associate with on a daily basis than the citizens they're supposed to protect and serve. They're corrupted. The CIA is populated with the same kind of people. Nelson Brigham, whom I mentioned in the previous chapter as the CIA officer who created the Phoenix program, told me this about his colleagues. "I have described the intelligence service as a socially acceptable way of expressing criminal tendencies. A guy who has strong criminal tendencies but is too much of a coward to be one would wind up in a place like the CIA if he had the education." Brigham described CIA officers as mercenaries who found a socially acceptable way of doing these things, and I might add, getting very well paid for it. Occasionally the cops have to arrest criminals and put them in jail, but it's generally the ones who aren't in the mafia or mafia guys who broke some agreement. If you're black or a minority, you're rarely going to benefit.
Christ, I saw something I didn't need to see and I'm losing my mind over it right now. All right, back to this.
From this accommodation the cops have with organized crime. What I witnessed was mind-boggling, and being 18 years old, I wasn't ready to think about it then. But I did think about it over the ensuing 20 years. And as I started researching and writing, that experience and some similar ones I had got me interested in the underworld. Things like the mafia's involvement in the Kennedy assassination. I wanted to learn about those things. In 1981, my father gave me the lesson that got me writing. We hadn't spoken in 10 years, but he'd just gotten out of the hospital after his second open-heart surgery and his defenses were down. He called me up and said, "I understand you want to be a writer. Come on home. I've got a story to tell you." Turns out he'd been a prisoner of war in World War II. He hadn't told anyone, but he'd been a POW in the Philippines in a camp with around 120 Australian and 40 English soldiers. My father was the only American and aligned with the Aussies. The camp commandant, a major in the British Army, made a deal with the Japanese. In exchange for having control over discipline in the camp, he would ensure that there would be no escape attempts. The Australians didn't care what this English major said, and four of them tried to escape. But the major found out and informed on them. The four Australians were brought back to camp and beheaded on Christmas Day 1943. A couple of days later, two Australians, along with my father, murdered this English major in retaliation. Nothing happened until the camp was liberated in October 1944, at which point the existence of the camp was covered up. The military gave my father a new military record and warned him that if he ever told anyone about the camp, he'd be prosecuted for his role in the murder of the English major. I wrote about that in my first book, The Hotel Tacloban. I'd seen the true relationship between crime and law enforcement, And after my father told me his story about the prison camp, I knew the military can rewrite history. It can coerce someone into silence so deep and damaging it causes heart disease. That was a turning point for me. I realized how deeply entrenched the corruption is, and I began to observe the forms it takes in our society, including racism. The double standard associated with racism allows one group to get away with breaking laws and unfairly punishes another group for breaking the same laws. That's corruption. It's organized crime. Meanwhile, the CIA, the military, and the cops are covering their collective asses through their propaganda outlets. They're corrupting our understanding of the world by controlling the information we receive. They create the myths we believe. If we were allowed to understand the CIA, we'd realize it's a criminal organization that is corrupting governments and societies around the world. It's murdering civilians who haven't done anything wrong. The military does the same thing in a more violent way. Cops, too. The Vietnam War had greatly affected my generation, and I wanted to find what sort of secret things the CIA did in Vietnam. As a first step, I spoke to the director of a veterans organization in New Hampshire, where I was living at the time. I asked if there was any facet of the war that hadn't been written about. Without hesitation, he said the Phoenix program. So I decided to write about Phoenix. I sent a copy of Tacloban to William Colby, who'd been director of the CIA and was closely associated with Phoenix. Colby read Tacloban and liked it. His reaction was, "Well, you have a basis to understand what happened in Vietnam." We did two interviews, and he introduced me to some senior CIA people who were involved in facets of the Phoenix program. It was incredibly eye-opening for me. I wrote about all that in the Phoenix program. In the course of investigating the CIA in Vietnam, I learned that huge amounts of narcotic drugs were flowing from the Golden Triangle area in Burma, Thailand, and Laos. The network began after World War II, when the CIA had set up a Kuomintang army in Burma. The Kuomintang was the ruling party of the nationalist Chinese, who'd been chased out of China by the communists in 1947. The CIA watched while the nationalist Chinese massacred about 30,000 people in Taiwan in 1947. The Kuomintang had fantasies of reconquering China, and the CIA played on those fantasies. It established a Kuomintang army in Burma and used it to attack China. At the same time, the CIA was conspiring with the Thai government, which was up to its eyeballs in drug trafficking. Opium trafficking wasn't frowned upon in that part of the world the way it is here, and the press here took little notice. By the 1960s, the CIA also had a secret army in Laos under Vang Pao, the leader of the Hmong tribe, who supported themselves by growing opium with considerable CIA assistance. The Hmong were looked down upon by the ruling ethnic Laotians, who ran a CIA-protected heroin processing operation. The CIA worked with the Hmong and Laotians just like the cops and the mafia ran that bookie operation in suburban New York. Opium from the Kuomintang army in Burma was moved by mule caravan to Wo Sai, Laos, next to the CIA's 118A base at Nam U. And from Wei Sai, it was flown to Taiwanese middlemen who worked with the mafia. Opium from the Hmong was converted into heroin in Vientiane. The CIA controlled the operation and made sure that some of the heroin and opium got to Saigon. Top generals in Vietnam controlled various provinces and regions like warlords. The CIA made sure.
That's the end of that one. Into the next one here. Yeah, Ken, this stuff hits hard. Like, the CIA are some really bad people.
These generals. They each had a distribution franchise, and they'd sell the drugs in their area and make huge profits off it, which is why they supported American policy and gave the CIA a free hand. By the late 1960s, most of the drugs were going to American soldiers. By 1970, the Nixon administration was aware that thousands of soldiers were addicts and that the problem was affecting the course of the war. Veterans returned to America with their habits, and the CIA was underwriting the whole thing. I was curious about how U.S. drug law enforcement dealt with the fact that American soldiers were being addicted and that tons of drugs were pouring into the U.S. thanks to the CIA. The DEA had to be involved in this CIA drug smuggling operation, and I was determined to write a book about that. My next two books, The Strength of the Wolf and The Strength of the Pack, focus on the corruption the CIA fosters within U.S. law enforcement. Those books are about the role the federal drug agencies play in protecting the CIA and its drug smuggling assets. I did interviews with agents, and I provide a lot of documentation. Most of that material is archived at the National Security Archives. The books also show how the drug law enforcement agency...
This is why it's hugely important to remember that what's going on in places like China, where there's massive anti-corruption campaigns, is that much of the goal of the Phoenix program isn't to have direct control of people, but to create corruption, to create officials that are greedy, bigoted, blackmailable maybe, but I don't like saying the word blackmail because in some contexts, to a lot of people, that could indicate victimization. Now, what we're talking about here is downright corruption, like quote-unquote seven deadly sins sort of thing here, which is to say that what we're talking about is dudes engaging in the continuation of community-destroying activities and exploitative practices like racketeering and the distribution of hard drugs, or turning a blind eye to the distribution of hard drugs. And it becomes a vast network problem at a systematic level after decades and decades of this. Because once it starts out, if you look at it at the individual level, individual cops doing this and stuff, bad. Then you add up at the next level, well, now you have oodles of individual cops doing this. Now it looks even worse. Now you add all of those oodles of cops into a nation of cops doing this. Now it looks even worse. And you keep doing this for decades, well, is bad.
Security Archives. The books also show how the drug law enforcement agencies make sure drugs get to despised minorities, people our rulers want to see in prison and politically disenfranchised. I show how drug law enforcement serves the national security function of making sure the right people get the drugs. Essential to this arrangement is the CIA's accommodation with organized crime. The gangsters are allowed to import and distribute the drugs in the major cities in exchange for telling drug agents which street dealers they're supplying. The hoods get rich by informing, and when the CIA has no more use for them, they're discarded like the generals in Vietnam. Dawson, let's talk about plausible deniability. Valentine. The CIA doesn't do anything it can't deny. A senior CIA officer named Tom Donahue told me about this. Colby introduced me to Donahue, and he was very forthcoming. Some of the guys Colby referred me to...
Yes, Ciparuski, this is the playlist that it's from. I'm just not playing it in the playlist because it's out of order in the playlist. Thank you, though.
We're hoping for the opportunity to tell their stories. It has to do with grandiosity. There's no point doing dangerous things unless the guys talk about your heroics in saloons. They saw me as a chance to memorialize themselves as heroes. But in the process, they had to explain a bit about how the CIA works. If not sources, at least its methods. Donahue was a prime example. He'd studied comparative religion at Columbia University and understood symbolic transformation. He was a product and practitioner of Cook County politics who joined the CIA after World War II when he perceived the Cold War as a growth industry. He'd been the CIA's station chief in the Philippines at the end of his career, and when I spoke to him, he was in business with a former Filipino defense minister. He was putting his contacts to good use, which is par for the course. It's how corruption works for senior bureaucrats. Donahue said the CIA doesn't do anything unless it meets two criteria. The first criterion is intelligence potential. The program must benefit the CIA. Maybe it tells them how to overthrow a government or how to blackmail an official, or where the report is hidden, or how to get an agent across the border. The euphemism intelligence potential means it has some use for the CIA. The second criterion is that it can be denied. If they can't find a way to set it up so they can deny it, they won't do it. Most everything the CIA does is deniable. It's part of their congressional mandate. Congress doesn't want to be held accountable for the criminal things the CIA does. The only time something the CIA does becomes public knowledge, other than the occasional accident or whistleblower, is when Congress or the President think it's helpful for propaganda reasons to let people know the CIA is doing this. Torture is a good example. After 9/11, and up until and through the invasion of Iraq, the American people wanted revenge. They wanted to see Muslim blood flowing. So the Bush administration let it leak that they were torturing evildoers. They played it cute and called it enhanced interrogation, but everyone understood symbolically. Dawson, they may have tortured people for 4 years. Valentine, they've always tortured people. Look at slavery. In America, the bosses cover it up, which goes back to what I was telling you at the beginning. If you visit Thomas Jefferson's estate at Monticello, you won't see the slave quarters. It's a cover-up, like the Hotel Tacloban. But unfortunately, many people like it that way. They prefer not to know. They prefer a poster with a happy cliché on it. If we all join hands and drink Pepsi, there will be peace in the world. Like any other kind of advertising, propaganda is meant to delude, not inform. But it's better to face the facts. While I was researching Phoenix, I found out about the CIA's involvement in drug trafficking. I also learned that as the Vietnam War was winding down, the CIA started reducing the number of officers serving in Laos and Vietnam. The CIA felt it had the situation under control there and was looking for new homes for these guys. I discovered that over 100 officers were funneled into the BNDD and DEA. These recycled CIA officers had been involved in Phoenix and associated programs, and I wondered, why are they going into the DEA? And who are they really working for? One of my CIA contacts was a fascinating man named Tully Acampora. Tully was a World War II veteran who started working for the CIA in Korea and ended up being detached to the CIA for most of his career. In Vietnam, starting in 1966, he was General Nguyen Ngoc Lon's advisor. Lon was famous as the guy who was photographed shooting a VC guerrilla in the head during the Tet Offensive in 1968. Al McCoy described Lon at length in The Politics of Heroin. Lon, McCoy explained, was Air Marshal Nguyen Cao Ky's deputy. After Ky was appointed premier in July 1965, he appointed Lon to head the National Police, the Military Security Service, and the Central Intelligence Organization. Lon established and managed Ky's political machine by using systematic corruption to combat urban guerrilla warfare. Corruption financed cash rewards for agents. Lon systematized the corruption, regulating how much each particular agency would collect, how much each officer would skim off for his personal use, and what percentage would be turned over to Ky's political machine. As McCoy noted, the opium traffic was undeniably the most important source of illicit revenue. And my friend Tully was Lone's CIA advisor until 1968, until the CIA decided to replace Ky's political machine with one under President Nguyen Van Thieu. Tully was one of the people that started funneling CIA officers into the DEA in the early 1970s. I don't want to bore you with details, but it's important to know why he was in position to do that. From 1958 until 1965, Tully worked for the CIA in Italy, and while he was there, he became close friends with three federal narcotics agents stationed in Rome. They were agents in the Federal Bureau of Narcotics, FBM. They were Italian-Americans, like Tully, and were making cases on the Mafia and its associates throughout Europe and the Middle East. Tully formed friendships with FBN agents Charlie Siragusa, Hank Manfredi, and Andy Tartalino. Siragusa was the boss. He'd been in the OSS and had worked with James Jesus Angleton in Italy during World War II. As chief of counterintelligence in the CIA, Angleton became dependent on Siragusa for his mafia contacts. You might have wondered how it is that the CIA can reach into the underworld and compel mobsters to do its dirty work, like the assassination attempts on Castro. Well, the CIA often does it through senior law enforcement officials like Charlie Siragusa. According to Tully, Angleton kissed Siragusa's ass in Macy's window at noon. Hank Manfredi had been in the Army CID in World War II and was actually a CIA officer working under FBN cover. He spent his entire career in Italy until 1968, when he had a crippling heart attack and returned to the U.S. The FBN had been reformed as the BNDD by then, and Andy Tartolino was one of its deputy directors. Tartolino arranged for Manfredi to join the BNDD first as an inspector and later as a manager in its foreign operations division. Siragusa and Manfredi were no longer alive when I started researching the CIA and the DEA, but Tartolino was. I told Tully that I want to learn about the CIA's involvement in drug trafficking, and he sent me to Andy. Andy became the DEA's deputy director of administration when the organization was formed in 1973. He was one of the most knowledgeable guys about how the CIA corrupted federal law enforcement. So meeting Andy was like meeting Colby. I now had an entree into the highest levels of the DEA. Tully sent me to Andy, and Andy said, "Okay, I'll talk to you as a favor for Tully, but first you have to start at the beginning with the Bureau of Narcotics. Spend a year, talk to as many people as you can, and then come back and I'll talk to you." That's what I did, and it was amazing what I found out. Tartolino had led a corruption investigation that lasted from 1965 to 1968. It resulted in 32 agents having to resign for committing all manner of crimes. 27 informants had been murdered, allegedly by FBN agents. None of the agents were prosecuted for those murders, but the ones who were suspected were allowed to resign. It was a cover-up, like happened at the Hotel Tacloban POW camp. Four or five agents were indicted for other crimes, and in 1968 the Bureau of Narcotics was taken out of Treasury and put in the Justice Department. It was merged with other agencies and reorganized as the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, BNDD, as a result of Tartolino investigation into corruption, mostly in New York City. The media loves to talk about corruption in foreign countries, but if you want to understand corruption, you have to study the relationship between crime and law enforcement in New York City. Siragusa, Manfredi, and Acampora were from New York. I'm from the suburbs, but my mother and her Italian-American family are from the city. Frank Serpico was a cop who exposed corruption in the NYPD in the early 1970s. He was a narcotics detective and was shot in the face by fellow cops. He survived and went to the Knapp Commission and revealed the extent of corruption within the NYPD. It was tied into what happened within the FBN, and Tartolino was involved in that investigation too. It uncovered rampant corruption among judges, prosecutors, and politicians, but they covered most of that up too, because everyone involved in law enforcement depends on corruption so they can send their kids to college, move to the suburbs, and take vacations in Mexico. They don't get paid enough otherwise. But I'm getting ahead of myself. As you're probably aware, opiates were legal until 1914, when Congress passed the Harrison Narcotic Act and the federal government started to regulate opium and cocaine. The act was a tax revenue measure. People who were importing opium and coca leaves into the U.S. had to report how much they were importing so they could be taxed and the government could make some money. The government regulated how much they brought in and which companies could manufacture it. This explains how it was that the Bureau of Narcotics was first set up in the Treasury Department. Within a few years, Congress decided that it should be a law enforcement issue. It was a way of giving doctors, drug manufacturers, and pharmaceutical companies a monopoly and sending anyone else who used or sold regulated drugs to jail. They created a narcotics law enforcement agency to find out who the addicts and their suppliers were and to put them in prison. They gave narcotics agents guns. This is during Prohibition, And anyone who knows anything about Prohibition knows that a lot of booze was coming into the country in police vans, and that cops were out on the beaches protecting the gangsters, unloading the ships, and making sure the police chief got the best bottle of scotch. Prohibition was the genius invention of Congress that allowed crime to become organized under the direction of law enforcement in the United States. Dawson, they made it the biggest black market ever. Valentine, all of a sudden, crime becomes as big an industry as the oil industry. As Meyer Lansky famously said, we're bigger than General Motors. Dawson, the same thing happened in Russia when they had prohibition. Valentine, the demand was huge. So illegal drugs became a big money-making facet of our business society, and the guys smuggling booze and dope became politically powerful. People like Arnold Rothstein, the Jewish mobster who bankrolled most of the bookie operations in America. Rothstein was extorting labor organizations in New York City. He controlled the booze coming in from Canada and by ship from Europe and Asia. He had the alcohol smuggling infrastructure, so he controlled narcotics too. He had a network of Jewish gangsters working for him out of Eastern Europe and as far away as Shanghai. The first international drug smuggling network consisted of Jews who'd been relegated to certain illegal occupations, like smuggling, through discrimination. They got pushed into this business and excelled at it. Rothstein's organization ended in 1928, when the mafia and the group of younger Jewish mobsters got upset because he had a monopoly. Lucky Luciano joined forces with Meyer Lansky, and they bumped off Rothstein and divvied up his empire. They incorporated crime and started dealing with the Kuomintang Chinese. That's the original syndicate. Before there was a CIA, the U.S. government was protecting the nationalist Chinese because they were fighting communists. The government protected Kuomintang opium and heroin routes into Mexico and the U.S. West Coast, which was another boon for this drug-smuggling syndicate run by the mafia. Luciano and Lansky organized crime on the totalitarian corporate model. They set up banks and created shell companies and paid off the cops at every step of the way. That's their plausible deniability. The CIA hired some of these drug traffickers in World War II for their expertise at creating false identities, crossing borders with contraband, and eluding policemen. The mafia also controlled many unions the ruling class wanted to subvert and use for its own purposes. Hiring drug traffickers was no big deal when you consider that the military and CIA recycled a slew of Nazis like Wernher von Braun and Reinhard Gehlen and used them in the secret war against the Soviets after World War II. Dawson, they consolidated power, too. They had Bugsy Siegel kick off a couple of dons. It really became a syndicate, La Cosa Nostra. Like you said, it became a real corporate enterprise. They consolidated mafia power. Valentine, believe me, it's not actually called La Cosa Nostra. That's an FBI invention. Nobody had heard the phrase until the FBI told Joe Valachi to introduce it to the public during congressional hearings in 1963. La Cosa Nostra means the Our Thing. That's the literal translation of La Cosa Nostra, the Our Thing. I'll try to explain how corruption evolves. When Rothstein was assassinated, the cops ran to his office. He lived in a suite at the Park Central Hotel, but had an office elsewhere. Unfortunately, someone else got there first and grabbed Rothstein's accounting books. Maybe that's one of the reasons he was killed. Anyway, panic ensued in New York because everyone was on his payroll. The state Republicans started an investigation that tracked back to Tammany Democrats. Republicans were running for Congress, saying, my opponent was on Rothstein's payroll, and here are the documents. Eventually, it tracked back to Republicans as well. The scandal also tracked back to the top federal narcotics agents in New York City and to Colonel Levi Nutt, who had been appointed in 1920 to run the narcotics division of the IRS Prohibition Unit. The Prohibition Unit was notoriously corrupt. It was in the Treasury Department, and Levi Nutt was in charge of its narcotics unit, and his agents were famous for being more corrupt than the Prohibition agents. The investigation of Rothstein ended up showing that narcotics investigator Levi Nutt's son-in-law was Rothstein's tax attorney. Village cops running the numbers racket with a mafia hood in the back of a bread truck is corruption 101. The PhD level course is the son-in-law of the chief of the narcotics division writing tax returns for the world's biggest drug smuggler. One narcotics agent told me there wasn't a drug deal that went down in Chicago in the 40s and 50s that didn't go through the cops to the politicians. That's still the case today, except they've gotten better at disguising it. They're able to hide the CIA's $50 billion budget. They're better at fooling the public, too, so you'd never in your wildest dreams think that your protectors are dealing with the people preying upon you. But that is a fact, and that accommodation between crime and law enforcement is the glue that holds the system together. Their most egregious crime is the systematic falsification of history. What starts out as an agent padding reports becomes, when all those reports are assembled, the myth of the cop or soldier or CIA agent as hero. FBN agent Frankie Waters explained it to me. One of my talents was testifying in court, Waters said. It was a situation that terrified me at first, but then I did it a few times and realized I liked it, because it fueled all the grandiose ideas I had about myself. And I was good at it. I could testify about a case made in Chicago. Walters smiled exuberantly. They called us pinch hitters. It didn't matter that some agents couldn't testify well, Waters added, especially in big cases where 20 agents were involved. Say Agent Joe Blow seizes the most crucial piece of evidence, a note that's essential for the jury to understand the case. Joe's a great agent, but he freezes if he has to speak in front of a crowd. A block away is his articulate partner. I'm the case agent to whom they both submit their memos. So when I write up the final report, guess who sees the note? As a way of justifying the systematic falsification of reports, Waters evoked the myth of the seasoned investigator who must bend the rules to get the bad guys. There's a bigger picture you've got to see, he stressed. There was a war between good and evil, and we were losing it. And it seemed that when justice triumphed, it was by accident. So let me tell you about integrity. On the one hand, you had the critics who couldn't make cases for moral reasons or because they were inept. On the other hand were the case makers, who knew we had to be the superior force because the only thing that kept the criminals from overrunning us was that they knew that our goon squad would wipe out their neighborhood if they tried. To show success to the politicians who control their budgets, top managers in every bureaucracy rely on fictionalized reporting. The essential fictions, like the need to bend the rules, are taught to new agents. The agents must learn them by heart to advance. Over time, the agents come to believe the fictions, which reinforce all their false assumptions about society and their role in it. For example, black agents in the FBN weren't allowed to supervise whites. The bosses said the blacks couldn't write well enough because in their reports they didn't ascribe to the fiction of white supremacy. Not until 1968 was a black agent made a group leader in the FBN. The organization, like American society in general and its security services in particular, accepted white superiority as gospel, and compulsory belief in that gospel paved the way for the political cadre at the top of the organizations to propagate other myths, like the myth that the communist Chinese were pushing drugs on Americans as a kind of psychological warfare, and the myth that pot was as dangerous as heroin. The most important fiction of all is the need for secrecy to preserve our national security. From time to time, that is true, but far more often, officials use secrecy to conceal their corruption and crimes. So Levi Nutt was shuffled off to Buffalo and given a sinecure job in upstate New York. And then the political bosses hired Harry Anslinger to run the Bureau of Narcotics, which was formed in 1930. Anslinger became the commissioner of the FBN when it was created. His job was to clean up corruption, and one way he did it was to limit the inspections staff. There were approximately 300 agents in the FBN around the country, and Anslinger had only two inspectors on his staff, one for agents east of the Mississippi River, and one for agents west of it. Periodically, they hopped on the train and visited offices around the country and made sure nobody was getting exposed in the newspapers for being corrupt. The corruption, obviously, continued apace. I met agents who had been in the FBN in the late 1930s. Most of the FBN agents I interviewed had joined after World War II. These were the people Andy Tartolino introduced me to, old agents who knew how things really worked. If anyone out there wants to know all the details, read my books, The Strength of the Wolf and The Strength of the Pack. Tartolino, however, only introduced me to the straight agents who had worked with him trying to root out corruption. I soon realized that was not how I was going to get the story, but through Tartolino and his clique, I knew who the corrupt agents were, so I went to them and presented them with a deal. These were the case-making agents Frankie Waters talked about, the guys who brought down the mafia and its French connection. These guys had no fear and no ethics, and that's why the first book is called The Strength of the Wolf. I went to this group of agents, maybe 10 of them, and told them individually what I wanted to do. I told them the story about my father and the bread truck and what I knew about the CIA. I promised I wouldn't link them to any murders or felonies. And on that basis, they agreed to talk to me. They talked about how they went about making cases. So if you want to understand the situation from their point of view, read the books. I can't explain it all to you in an hour, but I'll try to summarize it. Narcotics agents are agent provocateurs. They create a crime by setting up a series of undercover buys, which they do largely through informants who get paid or otherwise compensated for buying or selling drugs to people the agents bust. The best undercover agents would shoot heroin so they could pose as addicts and traffickers. These guys would do anything. But they had to provide heroin to their informants. An agent wasn't looking to cure an addict. He was looking to use an addict as an informant and sustain his habit while working up the ladder to his or her supplier. So the agents became suppliers of heroin. They became an instrumental part of the problem at the basic level, and that's still the case today, but on a grander scale. Agents are in the illicit narcotic business in both an official and unofficial capacity. Within the old FBN, a certain amount of illicit drug distribution was officially allowed. But behind the scenes, the case-making agents were competing with each other to make cases. In New York City, there were 5 groups of agents, maybe 10 agents in a group, and they were all trying to get promoted so they didn't have to be street agents forever, so they could become the bosses. Ideally, an ambitious agent latched onto an informant who could make a big case on a member of the mafia. Doing that guaranteed a successful career. But the competition was fierce, and sometimes an ambitious agent in one group would intentionally arrest another agent's informant for dealing junk. One case-making agent would subvert another case-making agent, and now you have life-and-death conflict between wolves. This is how informants ended up getting killed. The agents started bumping off each other's informants, and then each other. They killed each other. This was what got Andy Tartolino so upset. Agents were giving other agents hot shots. They'd slip heroin into someone's beer or tie him down and give him an injection of heroin and kill him. There were instances of this happening. So that's the level of corruption that permeated drug law enforcement. Without centralized control, it was a Hobbesian war. To make big cases, case-making agents needed to acquire heroin unofficially. They knew where the big dealers kept their stash, so they would burglarize an apartment and steal the drugs. They would cut the dope and resell it through their informants, share the profits, and make more cases. If they didn't get caught, they got promoted and became the bosses. Agents were raping women. A lot of addict informants were prostitutes, and the corrupt agents would force them to have sex to avoid going to jail. Agents were stealing money from floating crap games and gamblers. They were ripping off everybody, left and right. They were murdering people. So the FBN was dissolved in 1968 and reformed as the BNDD in the Justice Department. John Ingersoll, who had been chief of the Charlotte, North Carolina Police Department, became the director of the BNDD. The Johnson administration charged him with eliminating corruption, and the first thing Ingersoll did was ask CIA Director Richard Helms for help. Ingersoll told Helms that the senior managers of the BNDD, most of whom were former FBN agents, were still up to their eyeballs in corruption. The BNDD had 16 regional offices, and most were headed by a former FBN agent, and Ingersoll was worried they were spreading corruption throughout this new organization. Helms exploited the situation. He wanted to take over federal drug law enforcement, so he slipped a group of CIA officers into the BNDD, ostensibly to investigate the corrupt bosses. This actually made it into the 1975 Rockefeller Commission report about illegal domestic CIA operations. It's worth reading the two pages they devoted to this. I wrote an article about it called Operation Twofold. The CIA infiltrated around 20 officers into the BNDD. Each of these guys was given a job in a region. They were put in proximity to the regional boss and told to spy on him. Ingersoll thought the CIA was doing him a favor, which was very naive because the CIA used this secret program for its own nefarious purposes. You know the old adage about the camel that put its nose in the tent? Pretty soon the whole camel is inside. That applies here, and pretty soon the CIA had taken over certain facets of the BNDD. It was 1970, and people like Al McCoy were becoming aware of the CIA's drug connections in Southeast Asia. The CIA had to protect its drug smuggling operations in Vietnam or risk losing the war. It was not like the 50s and 60s. Press people were flying all over the world. They weren't taking boats anymore. They could communicate faster and learn things they didn't know before. Suddenly, the monstrous things the CIA had done for 20 years were in danger of being exposed. For 20 years, the CIA had been working with the criminal underworlds in every nation, doing exactly what the old narcotic agents did, creating crimes and covering them up. That's why the CIA wanted to commandeer federal drug law enforcement. Through Operation Twofold, the CIA infiltrated the BNDD's inspections staff and intelligence division. It created and staffed the BNDD's Office of Special Operations. It took over the BNDD's foreign operations and executive management staffs, and it still runs them today within the DEA. Dawson, the U.S. was getting opium from Afghanistan? Valentine, when the United States took over drug law enforcement in Afghanistan, opium production increased dramatically. All of a sudden, Afghan heroin is flooding the U.S. and Europe. It still is. You can say it's a coincidence, except all the opium warlords are on the CIA payroll. The DEA sends 600 agents to Afghanistan to make sure that nobody knows about it. Dawson, it's important to show what the money finances. It's more than personal profit. They use that black market money from the drugs to get into other shenanigans, supporting rent-a-terrorist groups. Valentine, the CIA is the most corrupting influence in the United States. It corrupted the Customs Bureau the same way it corrupted the DEA. It corrupts the State Department and the military. It has infiltrated civil organizations and the media to make sure that none of its illegal operations are exposed. Many CIA officers spent their careers posing as federal narcotics agents. Dawson, they're the managerial arm of the cartel. Valentine, it's the untold part of the Gary Webb story. Where the hell was the DEA? Well, the DEA was making sure no one made a case against CIA drug dealers. They make sure the drugs go to the black and Latino communities. In my opinion, that's the national security establishment's deepest, darkest secret. Exposing it was what got Webb in trouble, not a few inaccuracies in his reporting. The media's job is to bury stories about corruption, whether it's in Congress, law enforcement, or the CIA. It sticks to the fictionalized script and spreads disinformation about how things are organized and how they operate. They do it by telling the story in a certain way, just like Frankie Waters described how the FBN group leaders wrote reports. The DEA has a public affairs branch staffed by creative writers who filter out anything bad and tell you only what the bosses want you to know. The media echoes what the DEA and CIA PR people say, but it's a big lie, and it's pervasive. Part 1. The CIA's Phoenix Program in Vietnam, a template for systemic domination. The secret dominates this world, and first and foremost, as the secret of domination. Guide aboard, comments on the society of the spectacle. Chapter 3. The Vietnam War's Silver Lining, a bureaucratic model for population control emerges. The CIA's Phoenix program changed how America fights its wars, and how the public views this new type of political and psychological warfare, in which civilian casualties are an explicit objective. The CIA created Phoenix in Saigon in 1967 to neutralize the leaders and supporters of the communist-led insurgency in South Vietnam, referred to by the CIA as the Viet Cong Infrastructure, VCI. The targets were civilians who were working at regular jobs while secretly engaged in administrative and support functions for the armed guerrillas. These people were patriots resisting foreign aggression and seeking to take back their country, but they were considered spies and terrorists. American officials wrote laws that allowed U.S. military forces to detain, torture, and kill them by every means possible, including B-52 raids, battalion-sized cordon and search operations, and death squads. Phoenix was originally called ISEC's side for intelligence coordination and exploitation, screening, interrogation, and detention of the enemy. But the name was quickly changed for symbolic purposes. In time, the mere mention of Phoenix, the omnipotent bird of prey with a blacklist in one claw and a snake in the other, was enough to terrorize not only targeted members of the VCI, but the entire civilian population. Phoenix evolved from a rifle-shot approach to neutralize enemy leaders into a program of systematic repression for the political control of the South Vietnamese people. It sought to accomplish this through a highly bureaucratized system of disposing of people who could not be ideologically assimilated. The CIA found a legal basis for the program in emergency decrees and administrative detention laws that enabled American advisors to detain, torture, and kill national security offenders, as the VCI were legally referred to, without due process. The program was implemented over the objections of Government of Vietnam, GVN, officials who understood that it undermined their national sovereignty. Within this extra-legal judicial system, with its Stalinist security committees, a member of the VCI was anyone who didn't actively support the government. To be neutral or advocate for peace was viewed as supporting terrorism. Proof wasn't required, just the word of an anonymous informer. The psychological warfare aspect of Phoenix was so pervasive that people had to watch every word they said. Advocating peace with the communists was punishable by imprisonment without trial for 2 years or even death under the administrative detention laws. And the threat of being detained was a boondoggle for corrupt officials and professional criminals on the CIA payroll. Persons arrested as VCI suspects or sympathizers were released only when their families scraped together enough money to bribe the local security committee members. As a result, CIA officer Lucien Conin described Phoenix as the greatest blackmail scheme ever invented. If you don't do what I want, you're VC. Modeled by its creator, Nelson Brigham, on Ford Motor Company's command post structure, Phoenix concentrated power in a chief executive officer and an operating committee at the top of the embassy's organizational chart. The chief executive position, the Deputy for Civil Operations and Revolutionary Development, oversaw the Phoenix Directorate in Saigon. The directorate was headed by a CIA officer supported by a statistical reporting unit, which assigned a quota of 1,800 neutralizations a month to the Phoenix coordinators who ran the program in the field. But Phoenix was a CIA program And deniability was one of its main objectives. So the CIA left gaping holes in its safety net in order to facilitate the systematic corruption that ensured the program's true but unstated objective of terrifying the entire civilian population into submission. As CIA officer Frank Snepp wrote in Decent Interval, the Phoenix strike teams opted for a scattershot approach, picking up anyone who might be a suspect, and eventually, when the jails were packed to overflowing, they began simply taking the law, such as it was, into their own hands. The program existed in relative secrecy until June 1969, when numerous South Vietnamese legislators complained in open session about Phoenix abuses. Everyone knew that thousands of innocent people were being extorted, jailed, and killed, but the complicit American press corps never reported it. And in the absence of any objection by the American public, the CIA had no reason to relent. It was not until late 1970, when a handful of anti-war Phoenix veterans exposed the program's many abuses, that Congress finally launched an investigation. But even then, thanks to skillful dissembling on the part of William Colby, the erstwhile deputy for civil operations and revolutionary development in charge of Phoenix, the CIA was able to shirk any responsibility. At congressional hearings into Phoenix in 1971, Representative Ogden Reed, Democrat New York, asked Colby, "Do you state categorically that Phoenix has never perpetrated the premeditated killing of a civilian in a non-combat situation?" Conflating stated policy with operational reality, the master of doublespeak replied, "Phoenix as a program has never done that. Individual members of it may have done it, but as a program, it is not designed to do that." Colby, to put it mildly, lied. In actuality, the Phoenix program was designed to be mismanaged, to open the door to and incentivize bribery, corruption, and terror as an unstated policy lever for ensuring domination over the Vietnamese population. The other side of the story. Censorship of opposing narratives is one of the main mechanisms for controlling information. Americans rarely get to hear the other side of the story, especially during a war. But in late 1970 and early 1971, a Vietnamese reporter named Dinh Duan An wrote a series of articles titled "The Truth About Phoenix" for the newspaper Tin Sang, Morning News. Tin Sang was published in Saigon by Ngo Cong Duc, a member of the Vietnamese legislature. Half of Tin Sang's issues about Phoenix were confiscated by the secret police on orders from the Minister of Information, Truong Bu Diem, a CIA asset. An knew from personal experience what he was writing about. He'd been a translator for Major Oscar L. Jenkins, one of the CIA's special police advisors running Phoenix operations in the Mekong Delta in 1968 and 1969. "Phoenix," wrote An, "is a series of big continuous operations which, because of the bombing, destroy the countryside and put innocent people to death. In the sky are armed helicopters, but on the ground are the black uniforms, doing what they want where the helicopters and B-52s do not reach. Americans in black uniforms, according to An, are the most terrible." The black uniforms were members of American hunter-killer teams. The hunter team was a four-man unit, usually all Americans, sometimes with one or two Vietnamese, Cambodian, or Chinese mercenaries, called counter-terrorists, CTs for short. According to An, the CIA would send the hunter teams into a village the day before a Phoenix cordon search operation to map out the village and capture people targeted for interrogation. The next day, the CTs would return in black choppers with the killer team, usually 12 to 25 South Vietnamese special forces or rangers led by green berets. "When they go back to their base," An said, "they bring people's bleeding ears. But are these the ears of the VC?" CIA officials like Colby did their best to narrowly define Phoenix as a perfectly legal program targeting specific individuals. But like Snepp explained, and as An alluded to above, everyone was caught up in the dragnet, including and especially those who were perfectly innocent. "The original purpose of Phoenix," An said, "was to avenge what the VC did during Tet, which is why President Tu did not hesitate to sign Phoenix into law. But, he added, local officials, including the legislators who complained in 1969, knew nothing about the program except the decree. The central government didn't explain anything. Furthermore, the CIA and their assistants had a hard time trying to explain to province chiefs about operations to pacify the countryside and destroy the VC. Indeed, bombing villages and spraying fields with the toxic defoliant Agent Orange served only to kill, maim, and impoverish rural villagers. And despite the avalanche of American propaganda telling the villagers such operations were done for their protection, the rural population understood that such indiscriminate attacks were directed at them.
Oh, my mic was muted. I was saying, take care of yourself, Drezzy. Thanks for hanging out. See you later.
Them, not at a few specific VCI. By 1969, they also understood that American money and bribes prolonged the war as a means of preventing any coalition government being formed with the communists. They knew from first-hand experience that powerful South Vietnamese officials profited from the carnage, that corrupt province chiefs reported the damage to their American advisors, ostensibly to get compensation for those hurt in the attacks, but kept the money for themselves. The Americans knew their counterpart officials in the government of Vietnam, GVN, were keeping the blood money, but they wanted it that way. The Americans used those officials as straw dogs and blamed them for the problems they had created. It's the same patronage system that America imposes on any nation it wishes to control. In Vietnam, the patronage system enabled the CIA to maintain the illusion, pushed upon the American public by the complicit press corps, that it cared for the Vietnamese people and wanted to protect them, while assuring, through massive corruption, its freedom to pound them into submission, and, of course, traffic in narcotics. The result was a total lack of trust in the GVN, not in the VCI. As An noted, the rural Vietnamese wondered how Phoenix could turn things around, the same way average Syrians, Iraqis, and Afghanis wonder how relentless U.S. bombing and death squad operations are helping them, as opposed to helping the corrupt warlords and government officials on the CIA payroll that authorize the bombings and death squads. Behind closed doors, CIA officials like An's American boss, the aforementioned Major Jenkins, argued that Phoenix was needed because B-52 strikes and defoliation dustings did not destroy the VCI's lower structure. This unstated policy was proof that the CIA could not reach the VCI leadership, and instead opted for genocide, wiping out grassroots support for the insurgency through the blanket application of terror. In the process, An emphasized, Phoenix dragged everyone into its trap. For example, as more and more fields were destroyed by Agent Orange, people had no choice but to buy rice from Chinese merchants and smugglers. The CIA-advised special police knew this and accused them of collaborating with the VC. Naturally, the merchants and smugglers were then forced to bribe the police to keep from being arrested. This is how the CIA's patronage system of corruption turned into the greatest blackmail scheme ever invented. Anyone, including cops and soldiers, who visited family members in VC-controlled areas, was put on the Phoenix blacklist and extorted by government security forces. They were surveilled, harassed, and forced to become informants in order to protect their family members from CIA hunter-killer teams and U.S. military assaults. The CIA relied heavily on false accusations to terrorize the Vietnamese. An told of 5 teachers working for a Catholic priest in Vinh Long province. The women refused to attend a VC indoctrination session. When the group of actual VC were captured, they named these 5 teachers as VC cadres. The teachers were jailed without trial or evidence. That's why people feared Phoenix, An explained. The biggest fear is being falsely accused, from which there is no protection. That's why Phoenix doesn't bring peace or security. Adding to the terror of being falsely accused, detained, tortured, and even killed, was the fact that the CIA rewarded security officials who extorted the people. The CIA, Ahn wrote, spends money like water. Many agents from the different police in four corps receive money from the CIA, Ahn reported, in the form of merit pay. Money was spent bribing cops on the CIA payroll with telephones, generators, air conditioners, Lambrettas, and Xerox machines. Pretty secretaries and cash awards were lavished on officials sitting on the Stalinist security committees the CIA created to prosecute national security offenders. Conveniences given to committee members, wrote Ahn, made it easier for them to explore information from agents, leading to the arrest of more suspects and, consequently, more bribes. The corrupting effect of massive infusions of CIA money was no secret. In an interview for the Phoenix program, CIA officer Warren Milberg told me, I had virtually unlimited resources to develop agent operations, to pay for a staff that translated and produced intelligence reports. Milberg had more secret CIA money, he claimed, than what the official province budget was. While he saw this as creating economic stability, the incentive to sell false information served only to further destabilize Vietnamese society. The CIA had no way of corroborating the information it bought, but the accusations were nevertheless used to build cases against VCI suspects in order to meet neutralization quotas imposed by the Phoenix Directorate. It was a perfectly deniable facet of population control. Ahn stressed that CIA officers took no disciplinary action against officials who took bribes because the payoffs were often a vehicle for agent penetration operations into the VCI. As Ahn explained, the CIA works to keep some communist areas intact so they can get information. These types of covert intelligence operations were in direct opposition to the stated Phoenix mission of protecting the people from terrorism. Such covert operations were many and varied. Ahn noted that South Vietnamese CIA agents often posed as pharmacists or doctors. These agents would smuggle CIA-supplied medicines to VC hideouts in Cambodia in exchange for information. Phoenix, explained Ahn, was watching and talking to the VC while at the same time working to prevent the National Liberation Front from reorganizing the VCI. All of the above and more led Ahn to conclude that America was never interested in ending the war. The goal was total victory, even if many lives must be lost. Phoenix, for Ahn, was a mechanism to extend the war indefinitely with a minimum of American casualties. It was a cynical ploy used to pit the Vietnamese against each other and undermine their efforts to negotiate a peaceful settlement by fueling the conflict with money, lies, and psychological operations designed to destabilize the society. Phoenix is gone, but the method lingers on. Ironically, before Phoenix was adopted as the model for policing the American empire, many U.S. military commanders in Vietnam resisted the Phoenix strategy of targeting civilians with Einsatzgruppen-style special forces and Gestapo-style secret police. They resented the fact that military officers were being involuntarily assigned to the program. People in uniform who are pledged to abide by the Geneva Conventions, General Bruce Palmer said in a letter to me, should not be put in the position of having to break those laws of warfare. Unfortunately, the current stab-in-the-back generation of military officers, government officials, and reporters was forged on the anvil of defeat in Vietnam. This generation, which staffs the burgeoning number of Phoenix-style committees in the public and private sectors, carries the burden of restoring America's reputation for invincibility. This ruling class within the national security establishment, represented most perfectly by Hillary Clinton, knows that its enemies, foreign and domestic, must be suppressed ideologically as well as militarily. Thus, they have embraced the Phoenix concept of employing implicit and explicit.
Ron DeSantis is another example of this. I mean, Donald Trump isn't included in this list immediately, but he should be.
Terror to control, organize, and pacify societies. Phoenix was always understood as the silver lining in the Vietnam debacle. The aforementioned CIA officer, Warren Milberg, wrote a thesis in 1974 titled, The Future Applicability of the Phoenix Program. Many of the CIA and military officers I interviewed wrote similar papers extolling Phoenix. As I'll explain in greater detail in this book, Phoenix fulfilled its destiny in the wake of 9/11 and became the template for policing the empire and fighting its eternal war on terror. So successful were Phoenix operations in overthrowing the Ba'athist Party regime in Iraq that David Kilcullen, one of the U.S. government's top terrorism advisors in 2004, called for a global Phoenix program. The threat of a global Phoenix program is that it will become fully activated in the United States. If the CIA and military are successful at politically and psychologically neutralizing suspected terrorists, what is to stop them applying the full systematic extent of Phoenix-style operations to include political dissidents, immigrants, and despised minorities in America, just as they did in Vietnam? As Dinh Thuong An noted above, the program's stated policy, consumer safety, is contradicted by its operational reality. Buyer beware. This is nothing to take lightly. Security officials are adept at using doublespeak to hide repressive covert actions within intelligence operations, and they are using the exact same advertising campaign they used in Vietnam. When the Phoenix first arrived in America in the form of Homeland Security, it was advertised as protecting the people from terrorism, just as it was in Vietnam. Any domestic Phoenix-style organization or operation depends on doublespeak and deniability, as well as official secrecy and media self-censorship. The overarching need for total control of information requires media complicity. This was one of the great lessons defeat in Vietnam taught our leaders. The highly indoctrinated and well-rewarded managers who run the government will never again allow the public to see the carnage they inflict upon foreign civilians. Americans never will see the mutilated Iraqi, Afghani, Libyan, and Syrian children killed by marauding U.S. forces and their cluster bombs. On the other hand, falsified portrayals of CIA kidnappings, torture, and assassinations are glorified on TV and in movies. Telling the proper story is absolutely essential. Thanks to media complicity, Phoenix has already become the template for providing internal political security for America's leaders. The process began immediately after 9/11 with the Repressive Patriot Act, and a series of presidential executive orders that have since legalized the administrative detention and murder of American citizens said to be involved in terrorism. Like Kamal Derwish, killed by a drone strike in 2002, and cleric Anwar al-Awlaki, killed by CIA drone strikes in 2009. Since then, the government has steadily sought to expand its powers to target Americans. In an editorial correction to an article written in 2010 by Dana Priest, the Washington Post said, "The military's Joint Special Operations Command maintains a target list that includes several Americans. In recent weeks, U.S. officials have said that the government is prepared to kill U.S. citizens who are believed to be involved in terrorist activities that threaten Americans." The list of targeted individuals is growing, too, and the intent to kill them is there. As part of the National Defense Authorization Act of 2012, the military, no mention is ever made of the CIA, was given the right to administratively detain and assassinate U.S. citizens without due process. Right now, the authorization is ostensibly limited to extraordinary circumstances. But the public is being prepared for the worst. In 2013, Attorney General Eric Holder announced that President Obama has authority to use drone strikes to kill Americans on U.S. soil. The bureaucratic groundwork is being laid as well. Just as Phoenix intelligence operations and coordination centers were established in every province and district in South Vietnam, the Department of Homeland Security has now established fusion centers, and the FBI has established joint terrorism task forces to coordinate representatives from every police, security, military, and civic organization in every state and major city. The fascistic merging of government and corporate forces against the public interest is the most insidious facet of Phoenix in American society. And it is done with the full cooperation of the corporate media, which exploits each and every mass murder we endure, whether it is a terrorist attack or not, like the gay attacker's assault on the gay nightclub in Orlando, to terrorize the public into consenting to greater restrictions on civil liberties and more wars overseas. The success of the Phoenix Doctrine is most evident in the ability of its advocates in the ruling class to corrupt Congress and force it to divert massive amounts of public money into the militarization of foreign and domestic policy. The constant barrage of propaganda about looming terrorist threats and the lurid human rights violations of straw dog enemies abroad serves only to justify heavily armed police officers and National Guardsmen patrolling in paramilitary formations in our airports and train stations. Implicitly, the public knows those weapons can be used against them. Now that the corrupt and corrupting Phoenix institutional structure is firmly in place in America, it is only a matter of time until we enter the next Phoenix phase of explicit terror here at home. Chapter 4. The Systematic Gathering of Intelligence. A census, if properly made and exploited, is a basic source of intelligence. It would show, for instance, who is related to whom, an important piece of information in counterinsurgency warfare, because insurgent recruiting at the village level is generally based initially on family ties. David Galula. As counterinsurgency expert Galula noted over 50 years ago, long before the Internet made it easy for governments and Internet corporations like Google to amass and manipulate private information about individuals, an old-fashioned door-to-door census was an effective basis for the political control of large numbers of persons. So it was in South Vietnam, where in 1962 the CIA implemented its Family Census Program. The Family Census Program was the brainchild of Robert Thompson, a British counterinsurgency expert the CIA hired in 1961 to advise it on population control in South Vietnam. The CIA was still learning the ropes of modern neo-colonial repression, and it looked to Brits like Thompson for guidance. Based on his success in suppressing a communist uprising in Malaya, Thompson proposed a three-pronged approach that coordinated military, intelligence, and police agencies in a concerted attack on the underground communist resistance to American rule. Managed by the National Police, the census meant compiling a dossier on every family in South Vietnam. Along with everyone's name and the portrait of the family, the dossier included each person's political affiliation, fingerprints, income, savings, and other relevant information, such as who owned property or had relatives outside the village and thus a legitimate reason to travel. By 1965,
yes,
there were 7,453 registered families, primarily in Saigon and major cities. The family census dossiers also helped the CIA discover the names of secret Communist Party cell members in GVN-controlled villages. Apprehending these political cadres was then a matter of arresting their associates and softening them up until they informed. The idea was to weaken the insurgency by forcing its political cadres to flee to guerrilla units in rural areas, thus depriving the VCI of leadership in GVN-controlled areas. This was critical to winning the war, for as South Vietnam's President Nguyen Van Thieu once observed, Ho Chi Minh values his two cadres in every hamlet more highly than 10 military divisions. Thompson's three-pronged method was successful, but only up to a point, for many political cadres were not terrorists. As Galula wrote, many were men whose motivations, even if the counterinsurgent disapproves of them, may be perfectly honorable. They do not participate directly, as a rule, in direct terrorism or guerrilla action, and technically have no blood on their hands. Indeed, Thompson's systematic approach created little love for the GVN, as noted in the previous chapter, insofar as innocent people were routinely tortured or extorted by crooked cops. On other occasions, double agents tricked security forces into arresting people hostile to the insurgency. Recognizing these weaknesses, Thompson persuaded the CIA to organize a special police force, Kansat Dakbiet, later known as the Special Branch, within the National Police. The Special Police was to be composed, theoretically, of highly trained interrogators and carefully selected case officers, plainclothes professionals who, like FBI agents, could not be confused
for anything else. All right, on to part three. Let's go.
Used with regular cops. Many were trained at the Central Intelligence Organization, CIO, school of the CIA, established in 1961. The CIA used the same sophisticated method to recruit staff for the South Vietnamese Special Police and South Vietnam's version of the CIA, the Central Intelligence Organization, the CIO, that it used for recruiting cadres for the Korean CIA. As John Marks revealed in The Search for the Manchurian Candidate, the CIA sent its top psychologist, John Nguyen, to Seoul to select the initial cadre using a psychological assessment test. "I set up an office with two translators," Nguyen told Marks, "and used a Korean version of the Wechsler." The CIA psychologists gave the personality assessment test to 25 to 30 military and police officers, and then wrote up a half-page report on each, listing their strengths and weaknesses. Nguyen wanted to know about each candidate's ability to follow orders, creativity, lack of personality disorders, motivation, why he wanted out of his current job. It was mostly for the money, especially with the civilians. In this way, the CIA recruits secret police forces as assets in every country where it operates, including occupied Iraq. In Latin America, Marx wrote, "The CIA found the assessment process most useful for showing how to train the anti-terrorist section. According to results, these men were shown to have very dependent psychologies and needed strong direction." That direction came from the CIA. Marx quoted one assessor as saying, "Anytime the company spent money for training a foreigner, the object was that he would ultimately serve our purposes." CIA officers were not content simply to work closely with these foreign intelligence agencies. They insisted on penetrating them, and the personality assessment system provided a useful aid. By 1964, plans were made to center the special police in province intelligence coordinating committees, PICCs, in South Vietnam's 44 provinces. But first, the government had to secure Saigon. And in July 1964, 2,500 regular policemen were introduced into seven provinces surrounding Saigon. By December, 13,000 policemen were participating, of whom 7,000 were manning 700 checkpoints, and ABC TV had done a documentary on the program.
Across America and other countries, there has been a rise in the number of police officers recruited. And people have only really talked about it as budgets have gone up. But this is the kind of thing why I mentioned it and why I mentioned the Andor points, because a lot of people recognize things in Andor that they saw in their real life. And by me connecting this book to what the ISB and the Empire is doing in Andor should get you to recognize these things in that pattern of going, holy shit, it's happening right now. And that will help encourage you to get involved in the things you need to get involved so that you can protect yourself and your community.
Motivational indoctrination. At the same time as the CIA was forming special police units to identify, capture, interrogate, and kill secret communist cadres and their sympathizers in GVN-controlled villages, it was also developing paramilitary counter-terror teams to locate, capture, and kill cadres in rural areas. To this end, the CIA in 1964 formed experimental counter-terror teams in seven districts surrounding Saigon. The CIA provided money and supplies, while U.S. military intelligence and special forces provided training and advisors. Lists of defectors, criminals, and other potential recruits came from special police files. Key to staffing the counter-terror teams was the Motivational Indoctrination Training Program designed by U.S. Information Service officer Frank Scotton. As Scotton explained it to me when we met at his home in McLean, Virginia, the idea was to develop improved combat skills and increased commitment to close combat for South Vietnamese. This is not Psy War against civilians, or VC, he emphasized. It meant finding the most highly motivated people, saying they deserted from the army, typing up a contract, and using them in these units. Our problem, Scotton said, was finding smart Vietnamese and Cambodians who were willing to die. Volunteers for Scotton's paramilitary program tended to be overly aggressive mercenaries. Many were recruited from South Vietnamese Special Forces units based along South Vietnam's borders with Laos and Cambodia. On a portable typewriter, Scotton would type a single-page contract, which each recruit signed, acknowledging that although listed as a deserter, he was employed by the CIA in a sensitive project for which he received substantially higher pay than before. The most valuable quality possessed by people serving in sensitive CIA paramilitary projects like Scotton's was their expendability. Deserters, deranged desperados, and hardened criminals facing lengthy prison terms or execution were placed in special reconnaissance teams, outfitted with captured enemy equipment and clothing, and given a one-way ticket to Cambodia to locate enemy sanctuaries. When they radioed back their position and that of the enemy encampment, the CIA would bomb them along with the target. Minds capable of such scenarios were not averse to exploiting American soldiers who'd committed war crimes. Rather than serve hard time in military stockades, they would volunteer for and be accepted to do reprehensible jobs for the CIA's paramilitary special operations group. The CIA trained and treated its secret policemen differently than its mercenaries, but they were both CIA creations, and the CIA could plausibly deny them when necessary. And in each case, it got exactly what it wanted. Indeed, the counter-terror teams and secret policemen were the twin pillars upon which the Phoenix program would be founded in 1967. About the death squads he developed, Scotton said, "For us, these programs were all part of the same thing. We did not think of things in terms of little packages. That thing, of course, was a grand scheme to win the war, at the base of which were province interrogation centers, PICs. PICs and the systematic gathering of intelligence." John Patrick Muldoon, Picadoon to the folks who knew him in Vietnam, was the first director of the CIA's Province Interrogation Center, PIC, program in Vietnam. Standing 6'4 and weighing well over 200 pounds, Muldoon was a college dropout who, thanks to family connections, joined the CIA in 1958. He did his first tour in Germany and the next in South Korea. "I worked interrogation in Seoul," Muldoon recalled. "I'd never been involved in interrogation before. Ray Valentine was my boss. There was a joint KCIA-CIA interrogation center in Yandan To, outside Seoul." Muldoon was assigned to South Vietnam in November 1964. "I was brought down to the National Interrogation Center, NIC, and told, 'This is where you're going to work. You're going to advise X number of interrogators. They'll bring you their initial debriefing of the guy they're working on. Then you'll give them additional CIA requirements.' The CIA had its own requirements," Muldoon explained, "because the South Vietnamese wanted information they could turn around and use in their battle against the Viet Cong in the South. We were interested in information about things in the North that the South Vietnamese couldn't care less about. And that's where the American advisors would come in to tell them, 'You've got to ask this, too.' We had standard requirements depending on where a guy was from. A lot of VC had been trained in North Vietnam and had come back down as volunteers. They weren't regular North Vietnamese Army. So if a guy came from the North, we wanted to know where he was from, what unit he was with, how they were organized, where they were trained. If a guy had been up North for any length of time, we wanted to know if he'd traveled on a train. What kind of identification papers did he need? Anything about foreign weapons or foreigners advising them, that sort of thing." Built in 1964, the NIC was where the CIA coordinated strategic civilian, police, and military intelligence. It was located down on the Saigon River, Muldoon recalled, as part of a great big naval compound. On the left was a wing of offices where the American military chief, an Air Force major, was located. In that same wing were the chief of the CIO, his deputy, and the CIA advisors. The same CIA interrogators were still at the NIC 2 years later when Muldoon departed for Thailand in 1966. There were four interrogators when he arrived. Three were Air Force enlisted men serving under an Army captain. Muldoon's boss, Ian Sammy Sammers, was the CIA chief of the NIC and worked under the station's senior liaison officer, Sam Hoppler. There was a conference in Nha Trang in April 1965, Muldoon continued. They were putting together an interrogation center in an existing building and asked for help from the NIC. I was sent up there with the Army captain to look at the place, figure out what kind of staff we needed and how we were going to train them. And while we were up there trying to break these guys in, the CIA liaison officer in Nha Trang, Tony Bartolomucci, asked Sammy if he could keep me there for this conference, at which all of our people were going to meet Jack Red Stent, who was taking over from Paul Hodges as chief of foreign intelligence. Bartolomucci wanted to show off his new interrogation center to all the big shots. The military people from the NIC had done their job, Muldoon continued, so they left. But I stayed around. Then Tucker Gugelman and Red showed up for this conference. Tucker was chief of special branch field operations, and things were just starting to get off the ground with the PICs. A few were already underway, and Tucker told me, "We're going to build, 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 and I need someone to oversee the whole operation. I want you to do it." So we had this big conference, and they packed the interrogation center full of prisoners. Bartolomucci wanted to show off, so he got his police buddies to bring in a bunch of prostitutes and what have you, and put them in the cells. I don't think they had one VC in the place. After the conference, they all went back to the regular jail, and I went to work for Tucker. It's funny, Muldoon recalled, but me and Tucker used to talk about the PICs. He said something like, "John, if we lose this war one day, we could end up in these goddamn things if we get caught." "Well," I asked, "what would you do if you were in there?" He said he thought he'd kill himself rather than go through interrogation. Muldoon laughed. Tucker wanted to turn the PICs into whorehouses. The interrogation rooms had two-way mirrors. Tucker was a hero in the Marine Corps in World War II, Muldoon added. He joined the agency right after and worked in Korea running operations behind the lines. He was in Afghanistan and worked in training. He got to Vietnam in 1962 and was base chief in Da Nang, running everything that had to do with intelligence and paramilitary operations. When I arrived in Saigon, he was trying to set
I just want people to remember that many of the Americans who had won the war against the Nazis, they weren't really fighting Nazis because they wanted to fight fascism. They were fighting the Nazis because the Nazis were impeding American domination. That was what was going on.
Set up the Province Intelligence Coordination Committees with Jack Barlow, a British guy from MI6. Barlow had been in Malaya with Robert Thompson, and they were the experts. Thompson's proposed Province Intelligence Coordination Committee, PICC program, was designed to extend CIO operations into the provinces. Theoretically, the CIO officer assigned to run a PICC would guide, supervise, and coordinate all military, police, and civilian operations in a province. But the U.S. military refused to go along with Thompson's PICC plan, so, and please don't be confused by the similar acronyms, the CIA settled on its unilateral Province Interrogation Center, PIC, program. Starting in late 1964, the PICs became the places where the CIA hoped to coordinate its paramilitary and intelligence operations at the province level. The special police officers assigned to a PIC would interrogate suspects and then tell the CIA who and where the VCI were. The CIA's liaison officer assigned to the PIC would share the information with the CIA's paramilitary officer in the province, and the paramilitary officer would then send a counter-terror team to kidnap or kill the VCI. This was the 1-2 punch of the counterinsurgency.
They've automated some of this now. Some of this has become digital. Some of these roles are redundant now thanks to automation and digital technologies reaching the point that they are at. But this is still the general format that they go through. And it works to create chaos. And the goal is chaos. The goal is not necessarily to find and successfully eliminate the resistance. The goal is to oppress the people and cause chaos, because unlike in the movies, the resistance doesn't have plot armor. The resistance doesn't get plot armor. Rich accomplices for the resistance are hard to come by, and oftentimes they can't use their familial wealth the way they would like to, or the way that is demonstrated in the movies and the TV shows. The way in which you build political power to achieve success as the resistance is a hard road and a tough road. And if chaos is there and about in your community, it becomes even doubly harder, triply harder to do that task, because you're contending against so many different forces.
Through the PICs, the CIA learned the identity and structure of the VCI in each province, and through the CTs, it eliminated VCI cadres and destroyed their organization. The problem with the PIC in Nha Trang was that it had been built within an existing structure, so the CIA logistics staff hired Pacific architects and engineers, PA&E, to design a standardized facility that was strictly functional, minimizing cost while maximizing security. The CIA's logistics staff scouted out suitable locations and then, through PA&E, hired local Vietnamese contractors to build an interrogation center in each of South Vietnam's 44 provinces. Funds and staff salaries came from the CIA through the special police budget. After it was built, the CIA bought the PIC, then donated it to the National Police, at which point it became a National Police facility under the direction of the Special Police. The four region capitals also had interrogation centers. The difference was that region interrogation centers were larger and held, according to Muldoon, 200 to 300 prisoners each. It was the job of the CIA's liaison officer to convince the province chief and his CIO counterpart to find a spot near the provincial capital to build a PIC. Once it was built, the liaison officer became its advisor, and Muldoon helped him recruit its staff. Most PICs were built or under construction by the time Muldoon was transferred to Thailand to build the CIA's huge interrogation center in Udorn. Inside a PIC. One story high, fashioned from concrete blocks, poured cement, and wood in the shape of a hollow square, a PIC consisted of four buildings with tin roofs linked around a courtyard. In the center of the yard was a combination lookout water tower with an electric generator under it.
"You couldn't get the guards to stay out there at night without lights," Muldoon explained. "So we had spotlights on the corners, along the walls and on the tower, shooting out all around. We also bulldozed around it so there were no trees or bushes. Anyone coming at it could be seen crossing the open area." People entered and exited the PIC through green steel-plated gates, which were wide open every time I visited, said Muldoon, who visited the PICs only during the day. "You didn't want to visit at night when attacks occurred." PICs were located on the outskirts of town, away from residential areas, so as not to endanger people living nearby, as well as to discourage rubbernecking. These were self-contained places, Muldoon emphasized. Telephone lines to the PICs were tapped by the CIA. On the left side were interrogation rooms and the cell block. Depending on the size of the PIC, 20 to 60 solitary confinement cells the size of closets. Men and women were not segregated. "You could walk right down the corridor," according to Muldoon. "It was an empty hallway with cells on both sides. Each cell had a steel door and a panel at the bottom where you could slip the food in, and a slot at the top where you could look in and see what the guy was doing. There were no toilets, just holes to squat over." "They didn't have them in their homes," Muldoon laughed. "Why should we put them in their cells?" Prisoners slept on concrete slabs. Depending on how cooperative they were, you'd give them a straw mat or a blanket. It could get very cold at night in the Highlands. A system of rewards and punishments was part of the treatment. There were little things you could give them and take away from them. Not a lot, but every little bit they got, they were grateful for. Depending on the amount of VCI activity in a province and the personality of the PIC chief, some were always full, while others always empty. In either case, we didn't want them sitting there talking to each other, Muldoon said, so we would build up the cells gradually until we had to put them next to each other. They were completely isolated. They didn't get time to go out and walk around the yard. They sat in their cells when they weren't being interrogated. After that, they were sent to the local jail or turned back over to the military, where they were put in POW camps or taken out and shot. That part I never got involved in, he said, adding gratuitously that political prisoners were treated better in the PICs than in the local jails for common criminals. Public safety was advising the jails with the national police. Sometimes they had 60 to 70 people in a cell that shouldn't have had more than 10, but they didn't care. If you're a criminal, you suffer. If you don't like it, too bad. Don't be a criminal. Interrogation. According to Muldoon, the CIA interrogation process worked like this. As we brought prisoners in, the first thing we did was run them through the shower. That's on the left as you come in. After that, they were checked by the doctor or nurse. That was an absolute necessity because God knows what diseases they might be carrying with them. They might need medication. They wouldn't do you much good if they died the first day they were there and you never got a chance to interrogate them. That's why the medical office was right inside the main gate. In most PICs, Muldoon noted, the medical staff was usually a local South Vietnamese army medic who would come out and check the prisoners coming in that day. After the prisoner was cleaned, examined, repaired, weighed, photographed, and fingerprinted, his or her biography was taken by a special police officer in the debriefing room. This initial interrogation extracted hot information that could be acted upon immediately. The whereabouts of an ongoing Communist Party committee meeting, for example, and other basic information needed to come up with requirements for the series of interrogations that followed. Then the prisoner was stuck in a cell. The interrogation rooms were at the back of the PIC. Some had two-way mirrors and polygraph.
For those of you struggling with some of this, don't feel bad about skipping over this section of listening. This is very brutal. But it should give you an idea of what we face.
Machines, although sophisticated equipment was usually reserved for region interrogation centers where expert CIA staff interrogators could put them to better use. Most CIA liaison officers were not trained interrogators. They didn't have to be, according to Muldoon. They were there to collect intelligence, and they had a list of what they needed in their own province. All they had to do was to make sure that whoever was running the PIC followed their orders. All they had to say was, "This is the requirement I want." Then they read the initial reports and went back and gave the special police interrogators additional requirements, just like we did at the NIC. The guards lived in the PIC. As they returned from duty, they stacked their weapons in the first room on the right. The next room was the PIC chief's office, with a safe for classified documents, handguns, and a bottle of scotch. The PIC chief's job was to help turn captured VCI into agents and maintain informant networks in the hamlets and villages. Farther down the corridor were offices for interrogators, collation and report writers, translator interpreters, and clerical and kitchen staff. There were file rooms with locked cabinets and map rooms for tracking the whereabouts of VCI. And there was a room where defectors were encouraged to become counter-terrorists. Once an interrogation center had been constructed and a staff assigned, Muldoon summoned the training team from the NIC. Each member was a specialist. The Army captain trained the guards. One Air Force sergeant taught the staff how to write proper reports. There were standard formats for tactical as opposed to strategic intelligence, as well as for agent reports. To compile a finished report, an interrogator's notes were reviewed by the chief interrogator, then collated, typed, copied, and sent to the special police, CIO, and CIA. Translations were never considered accurate unless read and confirmed in the original language by the same person, which rarely happened. Likewise, interrogations conducted through interpreters were never considered totally reliable, given that significant information was generally lost or misrepresented. A second Air Force sergeant taught interrogators how to take notes and ask questions during an interrogation.
"You don't just sit down with 10 questions, get 10 answers, and then walk away," Muldoon said. "Some of these guys, if you give them 10 questions, would get 10 answers for you, and that's it. They had to learn that you don't drop a line of questioning just because you got the answer. The answer, if it's the right one, should lead to 60 more questions. Or for example," Muldoon said, "question 1 was, were you ever trained in North Vietnam? Question 2 was, were you ever trained by people other than Vietnamese? Well, lots of times the answer to question 2 is so interesting and gives you so much information you keep going for an hour and never get to question 3, when did you come to South Vietnam?"
Special police officers in region interrogation centers were sent to a special interrogation training program conducted at the NIC by experts from the CIA's Support Services Branch, most of whom worked on Russian defectors and were brought out from Washington to handle important cases. Training of administrative personnel was conducted at region headquarters by professional female secretaries who taught their students how to type, file, and use phones. According to Muldoon, the special police employed the old French methods. That means interrogation that included torture. All this had to be stopped by the agency, he said. They had to be retaught with more sophisticated techniques. The Vietnamese, however, did not change their ways. It's also important to note that they did not conceive the PIC Gulag Archipelago. The special police were the stepchildren of Robert Thompson, whose aristocratic Norman English ancestors perfected torture in dingy castle dungeons, on the rack and in the Iron Lady, with thumbscrews and branding irons. As for the American role, according to Muldoon,
you can't have an American there all the time watching these things.
These things included rape, gang rape, rape using eels, snakes, or hard objects, and rape followed by murder. The bell telephone hour, rendered by attaching wires to the genitals or other sensitive parts of the body, waterboarding, the airplane, in which a prisoner's arms were tied behind the back and the rope looped over a hook on the ceiling, suspending the prisoner in mid-air while he or she was beaten, beatings with rubber hoses and whips, and the use of police dogs to maul prisoners. All this and more occurred in PICs, one of which was run by former Congressman Rob Simmons, Republican Connecticut, while he was a CIA officer running the PIC in Fujian Province in 1972.
The PIC advisor's job was to keep the region officer informed about real operations mounted in the capital city or against big shots in the field, Muldoon said, adding that advisors who wanted to do a good job ran the PICs themselves, while the lazy ones hired contractors who were paid by the CIA but worked for themselves, doing a dirty job in exchange for an inside track to the black market.
Apart from serving as torture chambers, PICs were faulted for only producing information on low-level VCI. Whenever a VCI cadre with strategic information, for example a cadre in Hue who knew what was happening in the Delta, was captured, he was immediately grabbed by the region bosses or the NIC, where expert CIA interrogators could produce quality reports for Washington. The lack of feedback to the PIC for its own operations resulted in a revolving door syndrome, wherein the PIC was reduced to picking up the same low-level people month after month.
A lot of PICs didn't produce anything because the CIA advisors in the provinces didn't push them, Muldoon said. Some of them said, it's not that we didn't try, it's just that it was a dumb idea in the first place, because we couldn't get the military, who were the ones capturing prisoners, to turn them over. The military weren't going to turn them over to us until they were finished with them, and by then, they were washed out. This, Muldoon conceded, was part of the overall plan. Let the military get the tactical intelligence first. Obviously, that's the most important thing in a war. But after the military got what they could use tomorrow or next week, then CIA should talk to this guy.
That was the idea of having the Province Intelligence Coordination Committees and why the PICs became part of them, so we could work this stuff back and forth. And in provinces where our guys went out of their way to work with the MACV sector advisor, they were able to get something done. As of August 2016, one can assume that similar CIA networks of secret interrogation centers have been built to updated PIC specifications in every nation the U.S. engages militarily. Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, and Libya, etc. The black sites the CIA establishes in other nations by corrupting that nation's security forces will also conform to the updated computerized PIC design. Last but not least, the CIA's interrogation methods remain unchanged, though the organization is now more perfectly able to punish people by driving them insane. The military's side of the story. The military's side of the story was presented by Major General Joseph McChristian in his book, The Role of Military Intelligence, 1965 to 1967. McChristian arrived in Saigon in July 1965 as the military's intelligence chief. He recognized the threat posed by the VCI, and in order to destroy it, proposed a large countrywide counterintelligence effort involved in counter-sabotage, counter-subversion, and counter-espionage activities. In structuring this attack against the VCI, McChristian assigned military intelligence detachments to each U.S. Army brigade, division, and field force, as well as to each Army of the Republic of Vietnam, ARVN, division, and corps. He created combined centers for intelligence, document exploitation, and interrogation, and directed the centers to support and coordinate Allied units in the field. He also ordered the construction of military interrogation centers in each sector, division, and corps. McChristian conceded the primacy of the CIA-advised special police in anti-VCI operations. He admitted that the military did not have the CIA's sophisticated agent nets, and that military advisors focused on acquiring tactical intelligence needed to mount offensive operations. But he was upset when the CIA, without coordination with MACV, took over control of the files on the infrastructure located in the PICs. He got an even bigger shock when he was refused permission to see the infrastructure file by a member of the CIA. Everyone was competing for success. As a result, some CIA officers prevented military personnel from entering their PICs, and in retaliation, the military refused to send its prisoners to those PICs. As a result, anti-VCI operations were often poorly coordinated at province level. The U.S. military assigned intelligence teams to the provinces to form agent nets with the ARVN's Military Security Service, MSS. These advisory teams sent reports to the Political Order of Battle section in the Combined Intelligence Center, which produced complete and timely intelligence on the boundaries, location, structure, strengths, personalities, and activities of the communist political organization or infrastructure. Information filtering into the Combined Intelligence Center was placed in an automatic database, which enabled analysts to compare known VCI offenders with known aliases. Agent reports and special intelligence collection programs provided information on low-level VCI, while information on high-level VCI came from the Combined Military Interrogation Center, which, according to McChristian, was the focal point of tactical and strategic exploitation of selected human sources. By mid-1966, U.S. military intelligence employed about 1,000 agents in South Vietnam, all of whom were paid through the 525th Military Intelligence Group's Intelligence Contingency Fund. The 525th had a headquarters unit, a battalion placed in each corps, and a battalion working with third countries. Like the CIA, it also had unilateral teams working without the knowledge or approval of the GVN. Operational teams consisted of 5 enlisted men reporting to an officer who served as team chief. Each enlisted man functioned as an agent handler. Some agent handlers worked undercover as State Department Foreign Service officers or employees of private American companies like PA&E. They kept their military IDs for access to classified information, areas, and resources. Upon arriving in South Vietnam, an agent handler was assigned a principal agent, PA, who usually had a functioning agent network in place. Some of the nets had been set up by the French decades earlier. Each PA had several sub-agents working in cells. Like most spies, sub-agents were in it for the money. In many cases, the war had destroyed their businesses and left them no alternative. Agent handlers worked with PAs through interpreters and couriers. In theory, an agent handler never met the PA's sub-agents. Instead, each cell had a cell leader who secretly met with the PA to exchange information and receive instructions, which were passed along to the other sub-agents. Some sub-agents were political specialists. Others attended to military concerns. Posing as woodcutters or rice farmers or secretaries or auto mechanics, sub-agents infiltrated VC-controlled villages and businesses and reported on VCI cadres and the GVN's criminal undertakings, as well as on the size and whereabouts of VC and NVA combat units. Agent handlers managing political accounts were given requirements by their team leaders for information on individual VCI. The cell leader would report on a particular VCI to his PA, who would pass the information back to the agent handler using standard tradecraft methods, such as a cryptic mark on a wall or telephone pole that his handler would periodically look for. Upon seeing the mark, the agent handler would send a courier to retrieve the report from the PA's courier at a prearranged time and place. The agent handler would then pass the information to his team leader, as well as other customers, including the CIA liaison officer at the Embassy House, a CIA headquarters in a province or major city was called. The finished products of positive and counterintelligence operations were called Army Information Reports. AIRs and agents were rated on the basis of accuracy, but insofar as most agents were in it for money, accuracy was hard to judge. An agent might implicate a person who owed him money, or a rival in love, business, or politics. Many agents were in fact working for the insurgency, and as a result, all agents were periodically given lie detector tests. They were also given code names. They were paid through the Military Intelligence Contingency Fund, but not well enough to survive, so most dabbled in the black market, too. The final stage of the intelligence cycle was the termination of agents, usually by paying them off, swearing them to secrecy, and saying goodbye. Another option was termination with prejudice, which meant ordering an agent out of an area and placing his or her name on a blacklist so they could never work for the U.S. again. Third was termination with extreme prejudice, a euphemism meaning to kill, which applied when the mere existence of an agent threatened the security of an operation or other agents. Military intelligence officers were taught in off-the-record sessions how to terminate their agents with extreme prejudice. CIA officers received similar instruction. These methods still apply today, but on a grander scale. Military intelligence groups operate agent nets in the camp follower communities that surround the military's hundreds of overseas bases. Agent handlers conduct much of their business in the brothels and nightclubs that sprout up around the bases and provide sex and drugs to military personnel. These cottage industries provide what Warren Milberg cynically characterized in the previous chapter as economic stability. The agent handlers also spread money around, ostensibly for information, but actually as the preferred methods of bribing local officials to follow American policy at the expense of their own nation's best interests. Like missionaries of old, they preach the gospel and pave the way for capitalist investment. The end result is billions of unaccounted for tax dollars. Case Studies: Ed Murphy and Sid Towell. Sergeant Ed Murphy was trained as a counterintelligence specialist at Fort Halibut, then sent to the Defense Language Institute in Texas for Vietnamese language training. From Texas, he was assigned to Fort Lewis. On the plane from Fort Lewis to Cameron Bay, Murphy recalled, I was given an article to read. It was a study by the American Medical Association on interrogation methods used in the Soviet Union. It showed how to do things without laying a hand on a person, how you could torture a person just by having them stand there. Upon his arrival in Vietnam in May 1968, Murphy was assigned to 4th Infantry Division headquarters at Camp Nari outside Pleiku City, where his understanding of counterinsurgency warfare rapidly evolved from theory to reality. There were 5 enlisted men in his counterintelligence team, each with a sector, each sector having around 10 agents. The main function of the agents was to uncover VC plans to attack and sabotage Camp Nari. Murphy's agents, furnished by the MSS, acted as day workers on the base. He also ran a team of agents 11 miles away in Pleiku City. Sometimes the agents got tips about a suspected VCI, and when that happened, Murphy took the name and information to the local Phoenix coordinator. Phoenix, Murphy said, was a bounty hunting program, an attempt to eliminate the opposition, by which I mean the opposition to us, the Americans, getting what we wanted, which was to control the Vietnamese through our clients, the DMs, the Keys, the Thews. For Murphy, all other definitions of Phoenix are intellectual jargon. Once a week, Murphy went to the CIA's embassy house, where he and the other civilian and military intelligence people in the area submitted the names of VCI suspects their agents had fingered. The names were sent to the Phoenix Committee, which decided how to handle each case. Surrounded by a concrete wall, its gate manned by a Montagnard PRU team, the CIA compound was located in a remote corner of Pleiku. Inside it was a barbed wire cage for prisoners. The cage was too small for prisoners to stand up in. Murphy was not permitted into the PIC, which sat on a hill and looked like a U-shaped school. I would never see a North Vietnamese or Viet Cong soldier, Murphy stressed. This is post-Tet, and those people are dead. We're talking civilian infrastructure people supporting the NVA and VC. It could be anybody. It could be somebody who works in a movie theater, somebody sweeping up. When asked what kind of information he needed before he could have a suspect arrested, Murphy answered, "None. Whatever you wanted." When asked what sort of criteria he used to classify VCI suspects, Murphy replied, "Nothing. One of my agents says somebody's a spy. If I had reason to believe he's telling the truth, and if I wanted to bring somebody in for interrogation, I could do it. It was that easy. I had an agreement with the team leader that I could do anything I wanted. I wore civilian clothes. My cover identity was as a construction worker with Pacific Architects and Engineers." Murphy called his agents hustlers and entrepreneurs making money off intelligence. After noting the difficulty of verifying information submitted at Phoenix committee meetings, the lack of files and things like that, Murphy told how one female suspect was raped and tortured simply because she refused to sleep with an agent. "Phoenix," Murphy said, "was far worse than the things attributed to it. It was heinous, but no worse than the bombing. And I don't apologize, but it was a watershed for me. It focused things. I realized it wasn't just a war, but that based on the assumption that nothing is worse than communism, the government of Vietnam, backed by the U.S., felt justified in suppressing all opposition while extending its control throughout the country. That control, Murphy explained, served an economic purpose. An employee at Pacific Architects and Engineers told me about $2 million in materiel and cash being unaccounted for. That goods being sold on the black market didn't come from the Vietnamese, but from the Americans. In order to get into military intelligence school," Murphy continued, "I had to write an essay on the debate about the Vietnam War. The thrust of my paper was, what we do in Vietnam will come back to haunt us. It was a one-world thesis. And well, I go to Vietnam and see the bullshit going down. Then I come back to the United States and see the same thing going on here. I'm at the 116th MI Group in Washington, D.C., and as you leave the room, they have 9 slots for pictures, 8 of them filled. Rennie Davis, Abby Hoffman, Ben Spock, Jerry Rubin. And I'm being sent out to spot and identify these people. This is Phoenix," Murphy said, then added for emphasis, "This is Phoenix." In Nam, I had composite descriptions of a person's physical characteristics, but then I wasn't in a place where we had technology. It doesn't make any difference. The point is that it was used in Vietnam, it was used in the U.S., and it still is used in the United States. In 1969, Murphy was one of precious few Americans acquainted with Phoenix, and he was determined to make it a political issue. He came to that decision in October 1969, while participating in the March Against Death outside the Pentagon. "I was being surveilled," Murphy said. "I know because the people doing it told me so. I've been reading about you," one of the officers, Sid Towell, said. Having fought for his country in defense of its civil liberties, Murphy was enraged to learn that the 116th MIG was being used against American citizens exercising their constitutional rights to protest the war. To him, this represented the Phoenix mentality in the United States. "To me," he explained, "Phoenix was a lever to use to stop the war. You use what you got. I got Phoenix. I'm a former intelligence agent, fluent in Vietnamese, involved in Phoenix in the Central Highlands. That means I'm credible. I'm using it." Intent on making Phoenix a political issue to stop the war, Murphy joined forces with two other Vietnam veterans. At news conferences held simultaneously in New York, San Francisco, and Rome on 14 April 1970, the three veterans issued a joint press release laying out the horrifying facts about Phoenix. By then, the program was nearly 3 years old. Sid Towell's story. A graduate of Yale University, Lieutenant Sid Towell was assigned to the 116th MIG in Washington, D.C. in June 1969. As chief of a counterintelligence team, he reviewed cases, including the investigation into Ed Murphy's anti-war activities. Towell also conducted offensive counterintelligence operations that consisted of disrupting anti-war demonstrations by building bonfires and inciting people to riot, so the Capitol Police could be called in to bash heads and arrest demonstrators. During the period he was involved in military operations against American civilians, Towell was rated by his commander as one of the most dedicated, professionally competent, and outstanding junior officers I have had the privilege to serve with anywhere. But Towell didn't want to go to Vietnam, and in January 1971, he requested release from active duty, citing his complete abhorrence for the Vietnam War and the continued U.S. presence there. Towell filed for release under Army Regulation 635-100, but his request was denied and his 666 credentials withdrawn. He was sent to Vietnam in March 1971 as the Phoenix Phung Hoang Coordinator in Vung Liem District in Vinh Long Province. During his stint as a Phoenix Coordinator, Towell spent most of his time sifting through the district intelligence and operations and coordination center's target folders looking for aliases. A sergeant assigned to the DIOCC managed funds obtained from the CIA for informers and the PRU team. The sergeant also acted as liaison with the Vinh Long PIC. Towell lived in a villa with six other people in the MACV Civil Operations and Rural Development Support CORDS district team. Behind the villa were the PRU quarters. "We turned up the radio when we heard the screams of the people being interrogated," he said. "I didn't know what the PRU were doing 90% of the time," Towell explained. "They were directed by the CIA's province officer in charge. To clear operations against the VCI, Towell had to get permission from Tom Ahern, the CIA's province officer in charge. Regarding operations," Towell said, "I went after an average of 8 to 10 VCI per week. The special branch people would come up with the names, which I would check. Then the PRU went out. They went out every night and always killed one or two people. But verifying whether or not they were VCI was impossible. They'd tell you who they had killed, and there was always a name on the list. But how could I know? We had charts on the wall, and we'd cross off the name, and that was it." Towell kept score until the day the district chief took him for a ride in a helicopter. As they were flying over a village, they saw an old man and a girl walking hand in hand down the main street. The district chief said to the door gunner, "Kill them." The gunner asked Towell, "Should I?" Towell said no. "That was the beginning of the end," Towell said. "Ahern called me on the carpet. He told me the province chief was angry because I had caused the district chief to lose face. That was another reason why Towle didn't enjoy working in Phoenix. Ahern started a bounty program in which cash prizes were offered as an incentive to inform on VCI. Ahern even arranged a contest between the Phoenix district advisors to see who could rack up the biggest body count. Disgusted, the advisors got together and decided not to participate. A few days later, John Van, who ran all Cord's operations in 4 Corps, arrived in his private helicopter. He flew right into the DIOCC, Towle recalled. He was very critical. He asked where all the bodies and weapons were, then sent me into a funeral in progress. He had me open the casket to identify the body. I hated Van, Towle said. He was really into body counts. On another occasion, while Towle was eating dinner in the Cord's villa, the district chief stormed into the room with the PRU team and dumped a dirty bag on the table. 11 bloody ears spilled out. The district chief told Towle to give the ears to Ahern as proof of 6 VCI neutralized. It made me sick, Towle said. I couldn't go on with the meal. After the ear thing, Towle continued, I joined up with the air rescue team on one of its missions. I was promoted to captain while I was there and received a message from the district senior advisor saying, don't come back. So I went to see a friend in the Judge Advocate General's office in Kanto, and he reported the ear incident to General Cushman. The general came down in a chopper and handed the province senior advisor a letter of reprimand. After that, I knew I could never go back, so I had one of my friends in Vung Liem bring my bags up to Kanto. Towle was removed as the Vung Liem Phoenix coordinator on 20 July 1971. 10 days later, he received orders reassigning him to Kien Phong province. It was the proverbial one-way ticket to Cambodia, he sighed. The last 2 guys sent out there as Phoenix coordinators were killed by their own PRU. So I went back to see the major running Phoenix administration in Kanto, Major James Damron, but he refused to reassign me. So from there I went back to the JAG office, where my friend and I drafted a letter to the Phoenix directorate in Saigon. In his letter to Phoenix director John Tilton, Towle said that war crimes as designated by the Geneva Conventions were not uncommon in the Phoenix program. He requested immediate release from the program under MACV 525-36. The next day, Major Damron reassigned Towle to the Tuyen Bin DIOCC, the same DIOCC where the 2 previous triple sixers had been killed. To avoid certain death, Towle hid at a friend's house in Kanto until 10 August, when the new Cord's chief of staff, General Frank Smith, approved his release. Referring to the case that appalled us all, a senior Cord's official suggested that a records check be made in Saigon before an officer or enlisted man is assigned to a Phung Hoang position in Vietnam, as a way to reduce chances of assignment of unsuitable personnel. At the same time, unsuitable Sid Towle was quitting Phoenix. Cord's director William Colby was assuring Congress that no Phoenix advisor had resigned on moral grounds through MACV 525-36. Colby also told Congress that incentive programs, like the one Ahern organized in Vinh Long province, were not policy. At the exact same time, however, Phoenix director Tilton was organizing a high-value rewards program. In explaining the program to his wife, Tilton's deputy colonel Chester McCoyd wrote, "A very substantial reward is placed on highly placed VC political leaders, as much as $8,000 at the rate on the black market, or twice that amount on the official rate of exchange. Our idea is to induce the lower grade VCI to turn their bosses in for the bounty money." Said McCoy with dismay, "Our original proposal was watered down by the bleeding hearts who think placing a price on your enemy's head is excessively cruel. This despite Colby's support." Ultimately, the Phoenix concept is the sum of all the programs it coordinated, including the public information aspects, like the lies Colby told to Congress, that concealed its true goals and operational realities. All other definitions and expressions are, as Ed Murphy said, intellectual jargon. The point, Murphy reminded us, is that it was used in Vietnam, it was used in the United States, and it still is used in the United States. Chapter 5.
So I think this is a good spot to pause. I don't really want to do another one right now. I'm hurting and getting very, very tired, so what I'm going to do is let y'all go. We'll pick this up again tomorrow. Keep listening because this is good, and I am enjoying making sure that people get access to this, even if it's a bit of a rehash for some of you who have been here for a long time. Those of you who enjoy my content, please feel free to subscribe or donate. All of my links are here. You don't have to, though. This knowledge is free and available for you. Where is the... Here's the link to the part one, and there is a whole playlist that you can pick up. Got all of it in there. Enjoy it on your own time if you want. Come back with questions. Till next time, everyone. Take care of yourselves. Ta-ta.